Apologies.
Chairman Leader.
Chairman Leader, kia ora, Councillor McDonald. Any others? Could I have a motioner for that, please? Councillor Barrow, second. Councillor Clark, thank you. Four against, carried. There are no late items that have been presented for us. Order of business. There has been a change to the order of business that was published. The Central North Island Iwi Land Management Limited has withdrawn from the agenda. Alamoti Te Pau sends his apologies and is unable to attend and present at this meeting. So kuena tera. Okay. Declarations, conflicts of interest. Any declarations of conflict of interest? Kore kau. Ka pai, haere tonu. Okay, committee Māori minutes from the 30th of June.
Happy to move, those. Mr.
Kia ora, Councillor Rose, seconded by...
I'll second.
Kia ora, Matunguana. All four against, carried. Ka pai, koena. Okay, choice. We are now on to our presentations, whānau mā. We have four presentations today. If just in the spirit of keeping things moving along, if you could please reserve your questions for after each presentation. We'll have a little 5-minute Q&A directly after each presentation. Our first presentation off the block is we have Ora Balo Tūkaki and Willie Te Aho from Te Whanau Āpanui giving a presentation on Rau Kumara Pai Maunga project. Kei kora korua.
Aye. Kia ora. Kia ora toi. Thank you very much. Ngā reo, ngā mana. Ngā rangatira, ka huri ngā mihi ki a koutou, mihi mai te Kumiti Māori, me ngā whānau, katoa, tēnā koutou. Kua tai mai mātou ki te tautoka te kaupapa o tēnei wā, ko te raukumara te ngā here. Kōra bālau tōku ingoa no te whānau āpunui. No reira, tēnā tātou katoa. Thank you, whānau, for allowing me this presentation. It's just myself on this morning. Willie and I are on later on this afternoon. But hopefully this will work for our Zoom. I'm just going to share a screen and just start right into it. Let me see. Does that work? Everybody see that okay? Kapai? Okay, so I'm going to just turn off my video just because I have a little bit of a bad things here going on with our internet. But so what I wanted to sort of start to begin our talk was about what the Rau Kumara Pai Maunga project, where we came from, where we're at, and what's up next. And also a little bit about our relationship with Bay of Plenty Regional Council, or our future, you know, relationship with what that could look like. So the Rau Kumara Pai Maunga project is approximately, the forest itself is approximately about 200,000 hectares. And it's an ecologically and culturally unique landscape. It includes the Rau Kumara Conservation Land, the PCL, which is approximately about 110,000 hectares. And the forests adjacent to that are part of a predominantly Māori-owned lands. The Bay of Plenty Regional Council and the Porokia District Council are the two statutory authorities on the Bay of Plenty side there. And of course, we have the Gisborne District Council on the eastern side of the ranges. Now, the Rau Kumara represents pretty much a true mountains to the sea landscape, rising through coastal, semi-coastal, lowland, sub-montane, montane forest, and also with sub-alpine habitats. And the whānau āpunui Ngāti Porou, the two iwi from the central to the northern part of the Raukumara that have occupied the Raukumara for 800 plus years. Of course, we also share that whakapapa with Ngāi Tai, Whakatohia and Te Whānau Mahaki. Now, the main, threats to understand why we've come to where we've come to is that deer, goat, possum, rats and mustelids have created this ecological crisis across the Raukumara. And large-scale control of possum, rats and mustelids has never occurred. And so what you see here is pretty much what's going on in the middle, from the inside out, that the Raukumara has been eaten. No understory, forest floor has been hoovered up, and of course all these canopy gaps. So there has never really been any kind of large-scale control over the last 30 plus years, and there's been some deer control limited to a single area of about 30,000 hectares. Possum numbers range from mid to extremely high levels within the Raukumara, and is actually recorded as one of the highest density of possum at an RTC of 0.65 for those ecologically minded. And along with this, with threatened species that are endemic to the Raukumara, these kind of endangered or locally are now locally extinct. We also have things like this with, because of the whole understory being browsed out, now deer and now ring barking trees. This is a mountain totara on the Ngāti Porou side. So what we're now experiencing is these significant secondary impacts on water quality and aquatic life, soil health, erosion, river sedimentation, and forest carbon carrying capacity. So all of these aspects have been impacted. What I again, some more of, that's actually the Waipu River. It's one of the highest sedimented rivers in the world now. And this is on our side here. And this is up in one of the photographs that we took in the Raukumara, we went for a hikoi. So as you can see, there's a large-scale devastation that is often invisible to a lot of our eyes. And this is what really was the impetus to the momentum behind creating the Raukumara Paemaunga project. The other thing that I just wanted to show you was, I just took this last night and I wanted to have a look at the Google Earth maps. This is just at the headwaters here of the Raukokere River, and it goes off to the Waikura Valley, and along here is the rest of the Raukokere River. And this is a 2009 Google map, and you can sort of see here these slip scars along these lines here, up and along there. And what we've got is the geology of our Raukumara, which most people would be familiar with, is grey wacky. So it's already quite an unstable area. If you fast forward over here to 2015, so just a mere 6 years later, you've got the same valley that's there. Now we've got these growing slip scars up here. The same valley up here in 2009, here it is in 2015. Right, and so we're seeing these growing slip scars all along the area that's feeding back into our whole river system. And this is really incredibly important to realise that we are, what's invisible mostly to our public's eyes is really feeding into a system of escalating collapse. So the Raukumara Paemaunga project really has been developed through 2 to 3 years of iwi wānanga. And last year was pretty much our intensive wānanga year in which the proposal was written and drafted. And it was endorsed by Ngāti Porou Whānau Apanui, Hapu Chairs, Land Blocks. We also had other NGOs like Forest and Bird and Kiwis for Kiwi. Of course, we had representation from some of your workers from Regional Council and Te Papa Atawhai, and also some partnerships that we've now put in place with NIWA. And so having said this, this project has really very strong iwi support. But of course, this community work is ongoing to make sure that our community stays front and centre every step of the way. So by the end of October 2019, we had drafted the proposal. And by the end of February 2020, the proposal was submitted to Cabinet as part of the North Island Forest bid that went up. And then, of course, COVID hit us, and a number of negotiations direct with the minister occurred during that time. And all of us got spat out at the end, and we came up to the budget announcement in which we were then secured funding through this North Island Forest bid and part of the Jobs for Nature funding stream. So what's really unique about this project is that it's really iwi is front and centre in this partnership with Te Papa Whai. And it really has been driven by iwi with support from all of our partners. Our primary objective, of course, is to reverse this ecological decline of the Raukumara, species and habitat restoration, etc. But at the same time, reconnecting people to place. Now, this is a really important aspect of this program and this project, is because nothing, what we've realized in a lot of our biodiversity and ecological work is that mainstream agencies have reached a plateau, and that if we don't involve hapu iwi, they have the ability to halt operations. And so what we want to do is really build this tie-out capacity so that the project, whilst the funding lasts for 4 years, the current funding of 34 million over 4 years, the restoration plan itself is a multi-generational, intergenerational restoration plan. So after this this 4 years, the 34 million over 4 years essentially will entail 23 FTEs, 18 seasonal colour jobs, and that will all be implemented by and in place by the beginning of 2022. One of the most significant partnerships that we have is with NIWA and with a program called Carbon Watch. And this program, this research is about how we can start to measure how much carbon a recovering native forest is absorbing. It will also track climate change indicators across the wider Raukumara region. It'll track forest restoration impacts on forest rainfall and temperature and humidity. And so NIWA will establish two greenhouse gas observing sites in the Raukumara, as well as that being paired with a weather station. So this is really exciting. So of course, for the launch, we had the minister coming to Marainui Marae. We had an awesome day. Heaps of our whānau, Ngāti Porou, came over. It was from the very young to the very old, and it was a really great day. What we really saw there as part of that, and I just wanted to share with you the launch video. I think I've got time for that. Can everybody hear the sound? Our people have come together, bound by
whakapapa. Can you turn the sound up a bit?
Ngā manu.
Aye.
Ngā awa. Te whenua e here ai tātou ki te Raukumara. We were born to this place. We have endured the pain of watching the Raukumara decline, and in some cases, slip into the silence of extinction.
Ki ngā hua, ana ko ngā kai wera. Ko te awa tonu, wena tō iho matua. Yes, yo, ambeo kumko ki te whenua, ko o awa. Ka mau i tēnā hapu, i tēnā hapu. Ona mana, ki ngā ko awa, ki ngā awa awa. Ko te ingoa Raukumara, e hari i ngā maunga, e hari i te whenua, e hari i tēnei i tēnei, he ngāhere ne. Ko te ingoa Raukumara, tēnei kōrero i heke mai ahau i oku tīpuna, oku karaua kuia, kua tapaina te ingoa mō ngā Raukumara, kua kore i rungara.
The focus of the Kaupapa for the Rokamura Restoration Project has always been the health and the Māori of the whenua. We can understand collectively on how we can work together to restore that Māori at place within the Nahiri. The capability and capacity sits here within the rohe amongst the people and tangata whenua themselves. The challenge has always been the resourcing. And so with the resourcing that will come with this project, that actually allows that, that's that paradigm shift that is occurring where the department understands that the shift needs to occur and that actually you need to work in partnership and allow for those opportunities to happen. Our kaumātua, they've been telling us their stories for years and years, and then finally we have this opportunity to get in there and get the work done, and it's on behalf of our tipuna that we go in there and we do that mahi for them to save them and save these stories that are in there, save these experiences so that we can pass it down onto our mokopuna because time is running out.
At the moment, the Raukumara is, it's collapsing. You know, I've just come through the Raukumara with our whānau from Ngāti Porau, and we've seen the devastation in there. And we didn't do that last year or the year before. You know, we done that yesterday.
I think myself, the status quo hasn't worked, so we have to look at new ways of doing the business of conservation, and it has to involve the communities that live around the place or live in the place. I'm excited about the future because, you know, we bring our people along with us. They're going to be part of the solution.
The big mission is for the restoration of the Raukumara, for every species that has called it home for millions of years to be alive, well, thriving, and for us to be part of it. Well, over 10 years ago, we were fighting for the Raukumara base in the Moana, and now the Raukumara forest is calling for us, and that's where we're turning now.
Ngāti Porau and Whārau Panui took me into the forest with Graham Atkins. My overwhelming impression was a forest that was dying. Deer numbers had got so high, the deer were so hungry, they were browsing the trees, ring-barking them, eating the bark that they were so hungry. It's a forest in collapse. We can protect and restore it. That's what this project and this partnership is about.
It's time to save the Raukumara. It's my job, it's your job, it's everyone's job.
Aye, if I could tell you, I'll put me air two. Well, hey, well, it might be time to air two.
Kei te karanga te Raukumara, te Ngāhiri, kia tātou, hei orana, mō ngā uri whakatiku.
E mano mano he rau he oranga, e mano mano he rau he tipua, e mano mano he rau he tangata. E ko te Raukumara.
So, where we're at right now is we obviously the announcement has dropped and their funding has dropped. We're in this pragmatic approach beginning, which is essentially an establishment group coming together, collecting all the baseline information and identifying quick start projects, while at the same time we're developing the partnership model and also talking through with Te Papa Te Whai, Ngāti Porau, Te Whānau Apunui about what this governance model and operational model will look like. Once that's sort of established in October, December, then the establishment group will dissolve and the governance entity will take over and recruitment will begin so that by January, year one, operations will be either continuing or operational. So that's pretty much the kind of space we're at right now. I think one of the things that I did want to touch on in the couple of minutes left for me is talking about what are our challenges. And as you heard in the video, status quo hasn't worked. It just will not work in this space and also in a lot of large scale programs like this. I think Kaimo Mamaku is another program on your radar. And as one of the participants in the video said, my job, it's my job, it's your job, it's everyone's job. Like, how do we work together? How do we create an end-to-end scenario in this? The other challenge that we have because of the funding coming to us is that there's an assumption that $34 million is enough. It's not enough. It really isn't. This is 35 years of imminent of lack of any kind of pest control other than some goat control on the Portuki side of the Motu, and a little bit of deer control in the middle, but otherwise no large scale control has been done in the Raukumara. And so what we have here, and I wanted to just highlight this, this is the areas that Docklands Regional Council and have identified as high priority areas, high priority diversity areas. So the red is obviously at number one, high priority diversity, biodiversity. That orange is a second sort of high priority, and the green is the third high priority. And so you can sort of see that there's quite a significant patch there, and don't even get me started on the fact that Tangata Whenua didn't have any say in how these were labelled. But when we look out into the larger scale of what the Bay of Plenty looks like, we can actually see that this eastern area has a significant part of that high priority biodiversity. And so you could almost place all of these little green blocks into this one area and you would add up to what we've got here. And so this is a really important aspect of how, you know, this is my job, this is your job, this is everyone's job. How are we going to bring back and support a really significant ecosystem that feeds a lot of our water systems throughout the whole region? So one of those things that also touching on around the biodiversity is that we want to also find the story of the land that's significant to us. And so when we look at the regime in which these high priority areas have been labelled, we also want to do a series of programs that start to help our people identify or help us to visibilise what our people believe are the really significant areas. But here's the really kicker, is that we as a whole don't have a skill base that's fit for purpose to be a Taiao practitioner contractor in the scale in which we need it. So we have a handful of peoples that can do this job, but we also need to build the capacity of our people. And so building this Taiao capacity in paid and unpaid spaces is going to be really important. We've got to build a paid program, and we've also got to build a voluntary space. Now, as most of us who are on this Zoom call know, if we're Māori and we're involved in hapu iwi spaces, we know that we have a voluntary deficient population of hapu iwi. You know, Māori are pretty much overcapacitated and overloaded with voluntary mahi, from kohanga to kura to marae to tangi to hui hui. I mean, the launch was just one example. We spent 2 weeks just cleaning the marae inside out so that it was spick and span. Then we're catering on the day, and then we're cleaning up afterwards. That was all done in a voluntary system. And so when it comes to creating voluntary programs and projects, agencies tend to attract our Pākehā whānau rather than our Māori ones, because our Pākehā whānau, particularly an older generation, tend to have more time on their hands. And so we have to think out of the status quo, out of what doesn't work, and look at how we can make this work. Our desire is to really build almost like a potama pattern. We have to understand the stairway, the steps, in order to get to your ultimate goal. And this is the same with community engagement. First step is, how do we engage our whānau through, you know, reconnecting back into the whānau? How do we then build the Taiao capacity? Where is this line? Do they stay within the community voluntary space, or do they move up towards capacitising to being in a skilled practitioner space that can be a full employee? And so the real picture of what we wanted to create was really you know, identifying these biodiversity areas that our hapu iwi can also be involved in. And this is work that's outside of the Pai Maunga project. And really creating like a mini mountain to the sea, and creating a reality picture of what this work could begin to look like. And also really asking, how is Regional Council looking to invest in the people and lands of Whanau Apanui in this space? And so one of these spaces that this can occur that can really make a big difference in certainly some of the front country areas that won't be part of the Paimanga project is looking at working together in community engagement and steps to building a community workforce. We want to look at running, I've been working on with a number of whānau on putting together a 3-month cadetship. And so that it looks at a mini 15 hectares of mountain to the sea where they get skilled up, they get their tickets, because you, in any kind of voluntary program anyway, you still have to get your tickets. And you would be, they would be getting their quad, their chainsaw, their toxic handling licenses. And then when we're thinking about the potama pattern, you know that this is the first step to capacitizing community. You have to engage people and you have to create the relationship of the value system. So I'm going to, I know my time is running out, so I'm just going to end here with just this very short 1-minute video and then I'll hand it over to questions. Kia ora
whānau. Tēnā koe te tuahine, ki te mihi kia koe, ora, mō tēnā whakātūranga oho oho, anō hoki kia koutou, te whānau hapū iwi, mō tō koutou mahi, rangatira e hoa, he rawe, he rawe. So I'm going to open up for questions. I'd just like to say it's really amazing to have presentations like this from the eastern extremities of our rohe, especially for our more western colleagues, because as you pointed out in the video and the presentation, a lot of the public just do not know that the peril that taonga is under. Tēnā koe e te tuahine. We have questions already. Councillor White, he pātai.
Kia ora, ora. E, ngā mihi ki a koe. It's a wonderful presentation, thank you. For someone who hasn't visited the Raukumara all that much, who sits on the council, I have to admit to my relative ignorance in what's been going on there. So I'm going to ask what I think is an ignorant question. What contribution has the regional council given in support of the project that you're doing at the moment? I should know that, but I don't. So perhaps you can inform me.
In terms of directing the project,
yes.
No, there's not been any financial state. Yes, in terms of what the regional council has been doing as part of their program, they have a small amount of pūtea that goes towards some goat control. I know they've been looking at some deer control as well, and then pest weed, some investment in that space. But in terms of directly with partnering with Paimanga, this is the time to make that relationship stronger.
because I certainly, hear your comments around capacity, and I think we all sympathise with that as iwi. We're overloaded with all sorts of work, and we're expected to do much of the hard graft ourselves on the ground with limited resources other than each other. So I think it's an important, this is a significant project. I can see that. And, we're going to have a healthy conversation, I'm sure, within Regional Council as a result of your conversation. So thank you. Much appreciated. Mm.
Kia ora. Just wanted to add too, Matua, that the Regional Council has invested in the Kaimai Mamaku, and I think there's something like 1.5 million or so within a partnership space, as well as the business case plan that's going towards this Jobs for Nature bid. So I think, something on par with that would be reasonable and responsible. Kia ora.
Kia ora, Councillor White. I have a question from Councillor Rose.
Tēnā koe, Mr. Chair, and tēnā koe whai. Beautiful presentation. And again, my question might be an ignorant one because I haven't been over there as a Tauranga councillor. It's quite hard to get over there, especially without a license. Doesn't work as well. But look, I just wanted to ask a question about the rangatahi, because I saw that in your guys when you had the hui with the minister, that you had the kura there doing some kapa haka and all. So I was just wondering, in regards to some of the projects in regards to this project, how are you guys planning on bringing our rangatahi into the mix here and actually giving them that opportunity to grow their knowledge in more spaces?
Yep, beautiful question. And that's something that's ever more always on my mind. I've always been involved in a lot of symposium work where we've done, I did the Red Tide Climate Change. I don't know if anybody had been aware of that, but a couple of years ago. So now we're developing what we're calling Upanui Rangers, which will be going into our schools next year. And it will be taking 10 students from each of the kuras and developing and having a one-day taiao. And we've been talking with the kuras as well as about how we can create a taiao curriculum. And so a lot of that work's already been happening over the last few years. And then having symposium. Taiao symposiums. And so that means you have things like water quality, water ecology, foreshore bird, climate change, and that's all been organised for next year, however, I've been running those things all this year as well. So again, on voluntary time, this is sort of the space that we have to capacitise and build to make that far more resourced and far more impactful on the large scale that we need to.
Mr. Chair, may I first ask, how many kura are you planning on actually getting involved with this? And then I'll just add the comment now. I just want to say well done, because to do that much voluntary work, it does take a lot of effort and it does take a lot of time. And so I just want to say well done, kia kaha, and keep up the hard mahi.
Kia ora. We've spoken to two of our three schools and most of our kohanga. Our other third school, they've already developed the taiao program, so they're quite happy with what they're doing.
Kia ora, Councillor Rose. We have a question from Councillor McDonald. Kia ora, Matamona.
Tēnā koe, ora. Is it tuatahi, ka nuita mihi ki a koutou, mō tō mahi rangatira. I recall a presentation that you may have made actually when we were Kumiti Māori down in Kohi, may have been last year. Just want to say or congratulate you and your team for accessing funding from the Crown. But I hear the plea you're making that it is far from enough to maintain what you want to be doing moving forward. I just want to ask, have you made an initial approach to Regional Council yet around the support that you're asking for today?
No, it's needing to, we were really wanting to land what we had before we could sort of begin a more formal approach. And so obviously I've had various different meetings at different levels. And the idea now is to really start to curate what that support could look like so that there's something substantive that council and regional council can understand what might be their investment in this space. So I'm more than happy to begin that curating stage with people.
Thank you. Just one more question. You probably realise that we're starting to move into our long-term planning process. Are you anticipating making any application to our long-term plan?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. And I think that would be, that seems like the appropriate space to put funding investment for our taxpayers' money, from our ratepayers' money into this program would be through that process.
Ka pai. Thank you.
Ka pai. Kia ora, Councillor MacDonald. Councillor Thompson, he pātai.
Tēnā koe. What an amazing presentation. Absolutely mind-blowing. Thank you. The one comment that absolutely will stay with me was that this is about community being front and centre every step of the way. And what I'm really keen to work on is how can we look at our investment models so that we actually upend them to some degree and actually put communities front and centre of regional council work. So just carrying on from Councillor MacDonald, it would be wonderful if we could work together going forward into the LTP with a view to let's have a look at our investment models, making sure that communities are in the centre of it all. So look, just absolutely mind-blowing. Thank you so much. I feel very humbled. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kia ora, Paula. A final question from Te Taru, from Councillor White. You're on mute there, Councillor White.
Geez, I still haven't learned. Anyway, the 200,000 hectares of forest, about 110,000, I think you said, hectares, is in the Dock Estate. You know, I'd be interested in what level of support you're getting from Dock, but having said that, one of the criticisms of government agencies and other agencies is that we work in silos, and it would be really nice in a project like this, as large as this, is if all the agencies could be working together. So what's your experience of that interagency connection or connectivity or disconnect? You know, because I think that's a biggie if we can really mobilize that space, because you talked about cadetships, you talked about internships. These are all the things that we can tangibly do, you know, sensibly amongst each other. So your comment?
Firstly, we've had a really strong relationship with Te Papa Atawhai, and particularly with our regional area, which is Jade and the operation manager, and we're working through Michelle, and we have direct contact with the minister. So that line has been really good. Having said that, Te Papa Atawhai is a beast, and I'm sure you might even you know, equate but regional council is a bit of a beast too. Sometimes it's a bit disconnected because there's an either overload or a lack of capacity or a lack of relationship. And so I think the strongest thing that we can begin to do is build stronger relationships. And this forum is one way of doing that. Yes, absolutely, in terms of the way in which this is going to be successful is an and. It's not an either or, it's not one iwi, it's not one agency, it's all of us identifying that we are all connected through these ranges from the Raukumara right to the Kaimai Mamaku, through the Tuiruiras. You know, this is a range that connects us through land, through water, and through whakapapa, and through people, and through love of what we do for it, why we do it. And so this is a really important space for us to realise that in terms of the reach of the regional council, we want you to come down. We actually would love you to come down, see us, meet our people, have a look at some of the projects, and see what kind of resonates with the value systems that the regional council also holds dear to their hearts.
Ka pai, kia ora. We have one more last question from Councillor Winters. Kia ora, Kevin.
Morning team, kia ora everybody. Ora, yes, I recall the presentation you made to Committee Māori It was on the 11th of June last year, Order, because it was the day my first grandson was born, so I remember it well. I was on tenderhooks at the meeting waiting for him to be born. So, yeah, 11th of June last year. What I'm offering, Mr. Chairman, is we have a holiday home at Waiha Bay, and following on from Order's comments, I'm happy to open up our place to take my fellow councillors and staff up there to meet the people, see some of the projects, see some of the areas of landscapes that are deteriorating. So I'm happy to put that on the table, Mr. Chairman, free of charge to my councillors. Let's go up there and spend a night or two up there so we can be taken around this whole area, because it's absolutely magnificent land. And we need, like Paula, we need to get behind this group, and we haven't put any money up yet, but I can see it coming for it from us to match what we've been given from the Crown.
Papai, kia ora, Councillor Winters, for their generous offer. And that is a great way to end this presentation, as a demonstration of manaakitanga and mahitahi. And that is the kind of spirit and wairua that it's going to take for us to come together to do the mahi that needs to happen. So tēnā koe, Councillor White, and anō hoki kia koe e te tuahine, e te rangatira ora. Thank you for your clear, succinct, and persuasive also presentation. It's amazing to see that quality of presentation come to us, because it helps us do our job, which is to bring the resources to do this sort of mahi. So tēnā koe ora, kia ora.
Kia ora, kia ora whānau.
Kia ora ewa, kia ora. Okay, haere tonu tātou. We now have a presentation from Ngāti Awa regarding the Kore Haha Whakahau project. We have on the line Mikau Akurangi and Simon Stokes. Kei kona kōrua.
Kia ora.
Oh, kia ora. Kia ora kōrua. Kei a kōrua te rākau. Tēnā kōrua.
Kia ora.
We're trying to work out technology, so kia ora. Kia ora, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity today to come and share with you a project that we recently have introduced. I'll just share my screen so you all can...
Desktop. Yeah, ka pai koena. That's the one.
Is that up now? Yeah.
Aye.
So I just wanted to introduce a couple of our team members who have joined me here today. So I've got Simon Stokes, and you probably are all familiar with Simon, who's been a recruit who was recently at Bay Auckland Regional Council. Simon is the project manager for this new project, and recently, as of yesterday, we have got Eddie Sykes, who is our senior communications and engagement advisor, join our team also, and they're both online. So Kore Haha Whakahau has this vision here, as you can sort of see. It says, as the lands of Ngāti Awa flourish, opportunities abound for future generations to enjoy their ecological, environmental and cultural uniqueness. So this is the foundational vision that has been given to us for the project, and it sets out how all the decision making and all the outputs all have to come back to achieve this vision. I thought I'd just share with you a little clip, and it gives you a bit more insight into the project itself. I'll just show up. Thank you.
excited to announce Kurihaha Whakahau is a Ngāti Awa-led possum eradication project, an initiative between Te Runanga o Ngāti Awa, Predator Free 2050, Provincial Growth Fund and Te Papa Te Whai.
It's exciting for Te Papa Te Whai because we get to see a different way of how things can be delivered, but we still get to contribute. It helps to support a change in the way that we operate with treaty partners. While there's a focus on building capability and capacity of Ngāti Awa people, it actually helps Crown organisations like Te Papa Te Whai to understand that you can be a part of something, but we don't need to lead it. And actually being a true partner is to step back and see how we can thrive and we can totoko that.
My nan told me, when she was young, our ngahiri was thriving with life. I hope to see it like that again, and I want my mokus to see it too.
Well, Ngāti Awa's proposal was incredibly impressive in the fact that they'd spent a lot of time in the detail in regards to how they were going to go about the removal in this situation of possums out of their project area. They're bringing new thoughts and approaches to how we're going to do their eradication and the measures in regards to the bounce back of the biodiversity in their project area.
Kurihaha Whakahau is an opportunity to create employment for Ngāti Awa people, building a workforce founded in kaitiakitanga, resulting in improved social, environmental and cultural outcomes.
I am excited because there's an opportunity where I can get into a role of becoming the next kaitiaki to take care of our people and our whenua.
Kia puke ke mana warai, kia maumata popore. Cherish, appreciate and enjoy. Be determined and unyielding. Kia whakapūmau I te hihiri o ngā taonga tuku iho o tuakiuki. Perpetuate the cultural ethos and dynamics of the resources handed down by our ancestors. Kia kore e ko piko piko, so that it does not wander aimlessly hei aitua tai mate mate to become a casualty of decay. Ngaro atu, ngaro atu, ngaro atu, and consequently disappear into obscurity.
So that hopefully gave you a bit of an insight into the project itself. I'll just share my presentation again. Can everybody still see that one? Does that come through all right?
Yep, that looks good. Looks good in the count.
So just building on that, it is a possum eradication project. We have partnered with Predator Free 2050 and Te Papa Te Whai. So Te Papa Te Whai are a key partner in the project. They also have supported us through the Jobs for Nature Fund. So currently the project is being contributed through, funded through Predator Free 2050 and Jobs for Nature, but also in collaboration with Te Runanga o Ngāti Awa as well. What's unique about this project is that it's the first of the Predator Free 2050 projects in Aotearoa to be led by the iwi, and that's really important from the Runanga's perspective to pass down that intergenerational knowledge, but also to encapsulate the project in Ngāti Awa values that relate to mana, whakapapa, maori and tapu. The project itself, as described in these in this slide, has a range of outcomes. We want to develop methods and techniques to eradicate possums. Currently, the way that possums and pests are managed is that they are suppressed. So we're looking to eradicate, which requires a new way of doing things, coming up with new techniques, working in collaboration with other technologies and other companies that will help us develop those as well. We also, which the second one is a really key project outcome for us, is that we build the capability and capacity within the iwi and the hapu to increase our participation in biodiversity, biosecurity, and creating an employment base and building those opportunities. We want to, again, like I said, test new initiatives, create new technologies and methods for doing these things. We also want to foster innovation. We want to do this. It can only be successful, this project, with collaboration with other groups within our community as well. So through the community groups, landowners, anybody that has an interest in the same outcomes of the project. And also we want to introduce our mātauranga indicators to help measure the success and the health of the ngahere and the whenua through the mahi that we do. This is the project area. It's 4,700 hectares. As you can see, it's a mixture of both urban and rural environments, and also includes an island out in the Ōhewa Harbour as well. So it provides some challenges, and it also provides some opportunities. The area has been selected for a number of reasons. We have used the natural formations, being the river, the harbour and the sea, as defensive lines, so therefore creating us a defensive line along the bottom that we are going to come up with some ideas about how we can keep the possums out from this area here. So we've used our natural defences to help support the project and help to support our eradication purpose as well. These are just some examples of the types of things that we're looking at to support the project. As I kind of talked about in this slide here, we've created a defensive line across the bottom in the southern portion of the project. So there's going to be a mixture of conversations, a mixture of techniques that we're going to develop to create a defensive line across the southern end there. And a few other things that we've been looking at is some examples around modified farm fences. And these have been tested by others as well. The other examples are the types of traps that we might be using. And again, this is just an example of one of the ones that have been created by ZIP, which is Zero Invasive Predators. And they've got different modifications to these traps to help reduce, to help us target our possums. Again, different types of lures and monitoring, trail cameras to try and test out how these might work for us within the project as well. Again, this is just really broadly about how we're going to progress through the next 5 years. So the project is 5 years long, and that just sort of sets out here how we're going to go throughout the project area. We are going to be starting on Ngātauā Farm, which is identified on this slide here. And that's the end of the slideshow. So I'm happy to take any questions if people have any.
Ka pai, kia ora Mikel, for their presentation. I will open it up for any questions. Nā pātai koutou mā. Any? I do have a question, actually, Mikel, just to get it going, and it's around the relationships. Of course, on your southern border, you've got other heading into other iwi territory, so that's my first question around the relationships with your neighbours. But also with other care groups who are already actively doing this sort of mahi in the area as well, and how those relationships are going. Kia ora.
I think those relationships are integral. We need to all work together to achieve this eradication. And I think one of the key things is this project doesn't want to take over everybody's mahi. We want to complement that mahi. So at the moment, we're developing a communications plan about how we're going to, or communications and engagement plan about how we're going to be able to leverage and support each other and to start those conversations, because I see them as being very critical and their contributions critical as well.
Kia ora, Mikel. A question from Councillor McDonald. Are you still on mute there, Mate Moana?
Aroha mai, I was on mute. Tēnā koe, Mikel. Thank you for your presentation. First of all, I just really want to congratulate the three of you, really, and that's yourself, Simon Stokes, and Eddie Sykes, who are all ex-regional council staff, which I love seeing you sitting in the box seats, progressing iwi projects. I just think that's wonderful. To the point, I think it's a strategy that regional council should start to look at now, and looking at training Māori within council so that they are able to return to their iwi hapu with the necessary skills to do the mahi that you're doing. So congratulations on the three of you. I love it. And I am a bit envious, but I will move on. My question to you, Mikel, is your long-term goal to look at actually leading in the space and guiding others I'll just put it like as a lead agency in this role? Is it something you're looking at futuristically?
Definitely. I think this is just the first step in bringing ourselves together, piloting our thoughts, but definitely, and Simon is currently working on a strategy beyond our five-year project to understand what opportunities there might be for the Runanga to do further work, whether it's within the same project area, looking at other species, or looking beyond our project area to support other initiatives. But definitely, this project is the first step in a few more things that we'd like to see happen as well.
Kia ora. And just one more question, Mikel. You mentioned the use of Mātauranga Māori in your project around identifying measures. You will be aware that Regional Council has developed a framework so that Regional Council itself applies Mātauranga Māori within its processes. Have you yet had the opportunity to work with staff to talk about how you share your Mātauranga with Council and how that actually works?
I am aware of the project and the mahi that's already been done and being done. We haven't had any opportunity at the moment to have that, but definitely we'll welcome what that looks like and how we might work together and getting those outcomes. Yep, definitely.
Thank you. Thank you, Mikel.
Kia ora, Mate Moana.
Kia ora, Councillor McDonald. Councillor White, he pātai.
Yeah, kia ora, Michelle. Again, you know, another superb presentation showing that our people are really out there doing the business, you know, and therefore in line with that particular comment, doing the business is always comes back to levels of resourcing. You know, your endeavours to build a resilient project are dependent upon not just the human resource, but also the budgetary resources that come with that. What sort of level of resource support are you getting, and what level of support would you be hoping for in your five-year project?
So the project is just over a $5 million project. We will be looking for other financial opportunities through, maybe through the annual planning process, what was outlined earlier, and also looking at other funding streams. So definitely we're currently building our people resource within the project to align with our Jobs for Nature funding, but I think there'll be more opportunities that we'll be looking to or to the regional council as well, and have those conversations around what support might look like for the project and beyond as well. So those conversations haven't been had yet, but now that we've got a comms and engagement resource on our team, we can expedite those conversations a bit quicker as well.
Kia ora, kia kaha. Look forward to reading more about this. Kia ora.
Kia ora.
Kia ora, Councillor White. Any more pātai from the floor from Macau? We head to our next presentation. Kore kou. Kia ora, Macau. Congratulations and thank you for your really well done presentation. I think from Te Whanau Apanui and Ngā Tiawa, we're getting the message. So kia ora, Macau. Fantastic work. Ka pai. Kia ora. Tēnā koe e hoa.
Kia ora tātou. Ka ki te.
Kia ora. Okay, ka pai. Kia ora. Yeah, just to our presenters also, you are welcome to stay inside of the meeting and watch the other presentations. If you would like to do so, this is an open forum, and I think definitely the synergy between those last two presentations also, we're talking about the same thing, so yeah, please feel welcome to stay on the line. Okay, we are now heading to one of our staff, one of our general managers, Chris Engel, is the general manager for integrated catchments, and he is giving a presentation on our Jobs for Nature and climate resilience. Kei akwe, Chris.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah. Kia ora tātou. Ko Chris Engel, toko ingoa. I'm General Manager Integrated Catchments at Toi Moana Regional Council. I have a quick presentation. It's really an update for members. Maybe the first time some of you have seen it, but it's an update from a previous committee meeting on the Jobs for Nature, the different funding sources that we're aware of, and maybe a bit of a discussion about how the Regional Council is working alongside people like Doc and others, and trying to get, I guess, the Bay of Plenty's fair share of the government resources that are coming into the region. I do have to acknowledge that the previous presenters have done very exciting and visionary presentations with videos, and I have nothing of equal to offer you today. It's just a boring.
You've got to look at you.
You have to look at my PowerPoint slides, but they're just bullet points, Tataru, so there's nothing exciting there. I'm sorry about that. But anyway, I'll launch into it. I'll share my screen here. Hopefully this will work. Bear with me. Here we go. Can you see that?
Yep, it's there.
Cool.
Maybe put it into, yep, copy.
So COVID-19 obviously changed the world that we live in, and government made available this shovel-ready projects money. And it's come in lots of different packages, and part of my task for the Regional Council is to try and research where all of this money is and how we can work together to source some of it and to create jobs for our local people that are now out of work because of COVID-19. So it's all about job creation. It's not something I normally do. We normally do environmental work. And so we've got an extra job to do right now, and it's about job creation, particularly for our young people. So the funding categories that we found straight away was provincial development units seemed to have some funding that came in straight away, and I'm going to talk about the Kia Kaha project that's about halfway through right now, and some of you will know a lot about that. Also the Crown Infrastructure Partners, but that funding source came in early, and that more related to infrastructure projects. So for us, that is our work that we do for flood protection and stop banks. So we put some bids in for that. The Jobs for Nature coordinated by MFE, I'll talk a bit about that too, but that's happening right now. And Department of Conservation, Jobs for Nature, you've just been hearing about that from previous presenters. And there's one slide at the end that talks about 1 billion trees and the NPI funding. And that's a slightly different way of organising the money. They didn't actually put a fund out there for people to apply for, but it was more that they were able to, MPI were able to put forward money that were for existing projects like wallabies and wilding trees. So the main project that I'm involved in is the Kia Kaha Whakatāne. That's PDU funded or Provincial Development Unit funded. We were fortunate to win 2.1 million out of an $8 million project. The other 6 million is with WDC for regional wide projects, which mainly include pest control, coast care, and removing problem trees along waterways, and that's mainly Japanese maple trees. A bit of track clearance there as well. So there's several different projects to deliver there. The real difficulty with this particular project is that we have to spend the funds by the end of November. So we had a 6-month window, and actually once the announcement was made, it was only 5 months. So we had 5 months to spend this 2.1 million. I'm happy to report we are actually on track to spend it, because if we don't spend it, we have to pay it back again. And of course, we don't want to do that. We want to use it for local employment of local people. We have quite stringent monthly reporting requirements. So when you get these funds, it's great. It all sounds good, but then you have to do work to report. And particularly, we've found that MB is interested, and the ministers are interested in the number of people we've employed. That seems to be their main interest. So we're quite fortunate in that we have created over 70 jobs, and I think it's over 200 for the whole project. The Kia Kaha project. So there's a lot of jobs being created locally around Whakatāne, but also in other parts of the region. But it is only short-term job creation. So we're now looking, well, what's next for these people where we've created these jobs? Is there something else for them to move on to? And that's very important for me, because we don't want to sort of leave people out there with no work to go to. So, and that's where the MFE, maybe the other Jobs for Nature money might come into this. The other part that we've been successful in winning $23 million, which is a large amount of money, is Crown Infrastructure Partnerships. So this comes under my engineering group, and the main project we put forward was that Ringataiki floodway, which, as many will know, is costing a lot more money than we thought it was going to be. And we're very fortunate that the Crown has funded us at 75% of that $13.7 million that it will take to complete the project. And that will create 54 jobs over the next 2 years. So that's a great news story. We took the opportunity to throw another application in there over the Easter weekend. And those five projects you see there are what I wrote in the application. That's also been granted at 75%, which leaves the council a bit of a challenge in terms of finding the local 25% share for projects that weren't already in their annual plan, and a couple of those weren't in the annual plan. So there's a report going up to council quite soon to discuss how we're going to do that. And there's, we're estimating about 80 jobs across those other five projects, and that's a total of $17.5 million. With I think about $13 million coming from the Crown through Crown Infrastructure, which is coming through MB. That's not been contracted yet, but it has been announced, so I can talk about that now. When I go into Jobs for Nature, the MFE funding round, the first round gave us one of our applications came through, and I'll also note that we were supporters of the Raukumara Pai Maunga project, although that ended up getting funding, of course, by DOC, so they didn't need that MFE round in there. But we were quite often putting applications into multiple areas in support of iwi partners as well as projects that we were running. And this Bay Conservation Cadets is an example of an external group that's not part of the Regional Council, but they're an external conservation group that did get funding through this Jobs for Nature. So the Regional Council didn't win any projects ourselves, but there is another funding round coming up of apparently $55 million nationwide, and that those must be freshwater related. So you can't use marine ecosystem type things or pest management. It must be a freshwater project, and it must include a local funding share. And again, the focus, the big focus is on creating jobs, particularly for young people who may have been pushed out of work by COVID-19. So the Regional Council is currently looking at that fund and where we would like to put applications in and trying to get a region-wide spread of applications. But also we would love to hear from iwi groups who would also like to put funding in, because we would like to support your applications. Because I think this whole integrated approach is working very well for the Bay of Plenty, where we're all supporting each other. It does tick a few boxes once that comes to the application assessment stage, I think, in government. So the Jobs for Nature one there for Bay of Conservation Cadets, to go back to that first bullet point, and I know those words in italics are very small, but I just wanted to let people know that that Conservation Cadets program will be training up a 3 month program for young cadets. So you will end up having people employed that have those skill sets, like chainsaw licenses, and have some experience in working in the outdoors on trees and understanding te ao Māori worldview and that sort of thing. So these people will be available for projects in the future. So if we take a 3 or 4 year sort of view of this money coming towards us, that will be strategically important, I think, to have people ready to do the work. One bit of news that we got last night, this is yet to be announced, but it looks like the Regional Council may have been successful with some MFE funding for catchment work in focus catchments. So this is, there are 10 catchments that we've identified as focus catchments where we want to work with landowners to fence off waterways, retire the land from pastoral farming, and plant it out in native plants. And so that's work that we do anyway, and we've been able to bring some of that forward, particularly in the focus catchments, the Waihi estuary, Makatu estuary, the Nakaho stream, and some Rotorua lakes, and the upper Rangitaiki River as well. So there's some areas there that we're going to do some work on, hopefully if the we get approval of that, and that's 61 new jobs that will be created through that. So that's hopefully about to be announced. And then finally, the 1 billion trees. This is not really a project in itself, but it helps with all our native planting projects, because it means that Te Ururako's program will subsidise each plant that we buy. So, and one particular one is the Kaiati Falls focus catchment, the Whitetail Stream in Welcome Bay. That is an area where 1 billion trees has given us $300,000 towards a major planting project, which we've had to co-fund as well, but it shows the difference that it can make if the government comes to the party with these things. So we're really grateful for the Te Ururako's help with that one. The other one that I mentioned earlier, MPI, has come through with some funding for wallabies, which is well, I guess we've been waiting a long time for this, and it really increases the effort that we'll be putting on to trying to control wallabies. And I know they've been, well, I've been hearing that they're spreading out in the Eastern Bay, so it's timely that we have this extra money from the government. That's a 4 year program, and also there's a little bit of money there for wild and tree control. And then finally, the DOC Jobs for Nature programs. I don't know if I need to say much about that, because our first two presentations covered that in much more detail than I was actually aware of. So great to see you, Simon Stokes, and involved in that, and Eddie. I think we should, because of the people involved, we should integrate really well with that. Simon knows all of my managers, so he knows who to talk to if he needs some help, or just to work in with what we're doing. Te Arawa, of course, has won some funding as well through for some wetland work and other environmental work, I believe, as well. So we're working closely, particularly with TALT, on that. And we understand there is some more DOC funding available. It may not be very much, and it all will be delivered through or alongside Bay of Plenty iwi. So, and that's my presentation. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Kia ora, Chris. Thank you for that. And it's really heartening to hear you talking about integration, you know, making sure that we find the synergies between these projects. I will open the floor up for questions, but my question, Tuatahi, is around that integration. And you're talking about the Young Cadets Program. And is that the kind of thing that the Raukumara Paimonga project could access? Because Ora was actually talking about capacity building.
Yes, I think so. I think so. The conservation group there is Michelle Elborn, I think is her name, the CEO of that organisation. But we can certainly put you in touch and make introductions and that sort of thing.
Ka pai, kia ora. Any pātai from the floor for Chris? Oh yeah, we've got an analogue raising of the hand from Councillor Rose. Kia ora Stacey.
May I first say, Mr. Chair, that I do have my hand raised via Zoom, but I'll take the analogue hand up. Look, Chris, I first of all want to say well done to you and your team. So I was present in Rotorua alongside Councillor Knees and Winters, who are both on the call, and Councillor White as well. Sorry, Te Tauira, I won't forget you. When the announcement was made in regards to the 23 million. So I just want to say congratulations to you and your team. I know that Easter weekend was quite entertaining for you. So that's my congratulations there. In regards to you were talking about the transition process between the Kia Kaha project into more long-term mahi. What have you guys looked into a potential link between what we've got going on with this Kia Kaha project and the CIF, the Crown Infrastructure Funding projects that we have going on, such as obviously the Rangitaiki flood protection schemes, as well as the Kaituna Mall and others?
That's a very good question, Councillor. To be honest, I haven't asked the managers involved to look directly at that, but I do. I've had the assumption that because those are principally civil engineering projects, that you will not necessarily need people with the same skill sets that are being trained to do the planting and pest control, predator control work that other projects are doing. But we will have a look at that, because there may be some cross-pollination there between the skill sets.
Yeah, and I guess my other question is in regards to young people, because you mentioned young people a lot. Now, there was I don't know what it was, there was something saying that a lot of rangatahi are actually having to leave school and get mahi to help support their whānau. So have you guys, has staff looked into how we could potentially work with the polytechs and all and helping train the rangatahi who are leaving into jobs that are needed within the regional council in regards to things like the CIF or the Kia Kaha project or any other funding streams that are coming through at the moment?
Yes, I think with Kia Kaha, and that's the only operational experience we've had so far, is we've got people from MSD on our project steering group. So that's actually quite helpful, because they tend to have data on who's out there. But we haven't actually, as far as I know, worked with the Polytech. So I can certainly raise that at the next steering group meeting with the project manager of that one.
Kia ora, Councillor Rose. A question from Councillor White.
Yeah, kia ora, Chris. Thanks for the breakdown. It's good to see the funding pathways that are coming through in terms of focus on job creation. And I'm glad to hear your comments around building resilience into ongoing employment, because it's one thing just turning the switch and having short-term employment, but thereafter that is also extremely important. So thanks for that. I noticed that about five government agencies, I might harp on a little bit about this stuff, but about five government agencies are involved. I get the feeling that they're reasonably well coordinated in that space. I'm just mindful of the comments and the presentation made to the council by Ezra Schuster about this regional group bringing together agencies to work better together and to sort of break down the silo structures that are there. What's your sense of cooperation between the agencies? You know, that's always been a bugbear for everybody, really. How do they work together and how do we make sense of that that operation, if you like.
Yes, Councillor, I know exactly what you're talking about. Often I find that officials in Wellington are better at talking to us in regions than they are at talking to each other, you know, across the departmental boundary lines, if you like. So I know they're trying hard to do that, and I've seen that over the last 5 or so years. Namuta might want to comment on this as well, but I think we are, I mean, this is the reason I'm doing this sort of work, is to try and coordinate for them in a sense, and in terms of the Jobs for Nature work streams at least, so that when it lands on the ground in our region, that it makes sense for people and it does actually have the desired effect rather than cutting across each other or duplicating or that sort of thing. Namuta, did you have a comment?
Absolutely. So the Regional Skills Leadership Group provides for that key opportunity for connection in terms of those focus on the four bubble areas. I also attend a three-weekly whole-of-government meeting across the Western Bay, where different agencies, MPI, MSD, TPK, IRD, Corrections, and many more organisations get together and talk about the coordination of funding going on across the region and how we can look at better integrating key opportunities that are occurring. So, yeah, work is underway.
Kia ora.
Kia ora, Councillor White. We have a statement in the chat from Tawira, which is regarding making sure that we coordinate with Ngā Wānanga. Our Wānanga, which I'm assuming he's talking about Te Wānanga o Aotearoa, Awa Nui Arangi, as well as Tō Iho Mai, our tertiary providers inside of the region. How are we going about that, Chris?
I'm not sure that I've been linking it all with the Wānanga myself, but there may be others in the organisation that have been. I don't know, Namuta, if you've got any information on that, or Kat?
Kia ora koutou, this is Katarina speaking, everyone. We've developing a MOU with Te Whare Wānanga or Awa Nui Arangi, looking at how we can share resources and collaborate and synergise. So this is definitely an area that is going to feature in our MOU. And Tawira Gardner's also in this meeting. He may have some comments because he sits on the Awa Nui Arangi board. Kia ora.
I think word is sound as whakaru. So put his thing on the chat.
Oh, yeah, that's why he's putting it up on the chat. Kia ora, no, I think that brings a little bit of clarity around that. I think it's very important, of course, for all of us to make sure that we are connecting with our wānanga. We're nearly up. I've just got one final question. There was a note there around the social enterprise. Of course, it's great to talk about these things like social enterprise, and we're developing policy in that. But, of course, this is our first sort of real swing at it. Chris, and I'm just wondering if you're able to give some feedback on some challenges that we're facing with regards to rolling out ideas like social procurement.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Eattie. I think it's actually gone really well, surprisingly well, for our experience so far with the Kia Kaha Whakatane project, is we've managed to employ quite a few young people, both male and female, and they've been working very well. I think it depends a lot on who the supervisor is. So, you know, if you get good supervisors, then you get a good team culture, a good team ethic. People turn up to work, they want to be at work, they enjoy the work. So, we've been lucky so far. I think, you know, there's been the odd hiccup where maybe that wasn't quite the right fit. I heard of one yesterday that didn't work out. So, you know, but that's life, isn't it? So, overall, I think we've found it actually surprisingly easy to adapt to that new social procurement, which gives a particular weighting towards young women, young people, and Māori Pacifica people in particular.
Kia ora, thank you for that, Chris. And thank you for your presentation. Hey, didn't have the bells and whistles, but I think you got the job done. Tēnā koe e hoa.
Thank you.
Kia ora. Okay, so we're now moving on to a presentation from two EDA of sorts. We have Toi EDA from the Eastern Bay, which is the EDA from around the Whakatane district and the Eastern Bay. And we also have a presentation from Toi Kairawa, which is an EDA of sorts, but is regionally focused in the Māori economic space, who are also giving a presentation. But we have Toi EDA up first, and we have Ian Morton and Kyle Graydon from Toi EDA. Kei kuna korua, are you both there? Oh yeah, we can nearly hear you. You might have to turn your volumes up. It's a bit quiet.
Can you not hear us at all?
We can hear you a little bit, but it's quite.
Kia ora, morena, everyone. Ko mau te maunga. Ko tauranga moana, te moana, ko anō tauranga moana ahau, ko Graydon toko whanau, e ko Kyle toko ingoa. Morning, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk today. It's quite a privilege to be here with so many people. My name is Kyle Graydon, and I am General Manager for Toi EDA. My role is to look after the forward-facing strategy of our entity. And I'll just let Ian to introduce himself before we get into the presentation.
Morena. Ko Tintu toko moanga, ko Clyde toko awa, ko Douglas toko iwi, ko Morton toko whenua, ko Ian toko ingoa. Good morning, everyone. My name's Ian Morton. I'm the GM for operations within Toi EDA. It's really nice to see lots of familiar faces on the call today. So thanks for the opportunity to be able to talk today.
It's even better for us to be able to do this together with Toi Kairawa. It's wonderful. So we'll just share our presentation here and get going. A little bit of background as to who we are as an organisation. We are the Eastern Bay of Plenty's Economic Development Agency. We are funded by the four councils, Bay of Plenty Regional Council. We have the Opotiki District Council, the Whakatane District Council, and Kawarau District Council funding us. Our objective and vision is quite simple. Our objective is to create a better future for the next generation. So who are we? Well, we have a board which is made up by our funding representatives, and we have two representatives on our board to be appointed on behalf of the Matatua Waka by Ngāti Awa. We've been actively represented by, the Matatua Waka, sorry, has been actively represented by Anthony Olsen in recent years, and we are working with Joe Harawira at the moment to work on the next nominations to represent Matatua. We do have representation from across the entire region, our board. We have Arahia, we have Ray Sharp, Whittemu, John Galbraith, who is our interim chair, Aaron Milne, and Tina Ngātai. Tina Ngātai happens to be the Bay of Plenty Regional Council's representative on our board. So we're very lucky. We obviously have Arahia's links back into Whakatohia. Anthony is Ngāti Rangatihi, and Whittemu is Tūhoe. So we've got quite a diverse board. It's fantastic for us. We are very much outcome focused rather than trying to work on the internal machinations of some EDAs. We're really focused on what the end game is. And we're trying to do this not by trying to do it all ourselves, but by working collaboratively with people, largely with our iwi partners across the rohi, to in partnership to achieve our outcomes. We don't necessarily have to own or do everything. So we have a very simple strategy. As I said, our vision is to create a better future and ensure that the future generations have better opportunities and outcomes. We have three very simple pillars. The first, our strategic pillar around creating a winning brand, is one of creating hope, for our people, for reasons for they can stay here, live here, invest here, and move back home. It's really about bringing our talent that has left our rahi back home and ensure that they are able to have an optimistic, great opportunity in front of them when they do that. It's making sure that the people that have remained here have great, meaningful jobs and a sustainable future economically. We've been doing a lot of work on the back of some of the recent successes we've had in the Provincial Growth Fund, for example, where we've been focused on rangatahi and focusing on the messaging back into the schools around what's happening in our region. We've been doing a lot of publications of good news stories. I've actually been receiving a lot of phone calls as a result of those over the course of the last weeks. We've only begun to do this. We've been quite humble in the first 12, 15 months that Ian and I have been in this role where we haven't talked about what's going on as vocally as we could have. We've actually waited to get the mahi done and then begun to tell other people's story about Eastern Bay and everyone, the successes of the people that are in our rahi here. So we've now got an active Facebook channel to engage with the rangatahi and stakeholders across the region. It's been very, very effective for us. I've been doing a number of radio interviews and focusing some of the broader business publications, such as the Bay News, Bay Business News, sorry, around what it is that we're doing and why people should be moving here. I'll hand over to Ian to talk about the economic development side.
Thanks, Carl. So just from a sustainable economic development side, we've taken a very targeted approach over the last 18 months, which is all around how much PGF money we can bring to the Eastern Bay. That was driven from a strategy that was signed off by the iwi chairs alongside the local government representatives on targeting against four key specific areas. One around aquaculture, one around high value horticulture, one around Kawarau industrial development, and the last one around tourism in the Whakatane area. So we've taken a very specific approach to target funding. So to date, for the Eastern Bay alone, we've secured 242 million of PGF funding over the last 2 years. And that's just phenomenal for our region. It's going to be catalytic over the next 3 to 5 years from an economic development perspective. In addition to that, there's also been additional funding coming in. Chris mentioned about some of the CIP funding that's arrived. Some of the BOPRC funding is coming into the Eastern Bay, but also there's additional CIP funding through the likes of Apodiki, and there's also the 1 billion trees funding that's been provided direct. So there's another 62 million of additional funding from the likes of CIP and other funding outside the PGF that's landed. So in total, $304 million that's being invested from central government. When you look at some of these PGF projects, in addition to the central government funding, there's co-investment required. So that then takes our investment profile for the Eastern Bay to around $450 million over the next 3 to 5 years. And that's co-funding from the private investors alongside the central government funding. That equates to around 4,000 jobs. So that is significant for the Eastern Bay, and it's going to be, from our point of view, once in a generation step forward to bring the Eastern Bay up to where everyone else in New Zealand is, because we've been lagging behind from a lot of the social statistics. I'll just talk very briefly around the partnerships that we've been working on. So in the we've been working really closely with Te Whanau Apanui on the high value hort. So they've obviously got additional kiwi fruit funding at Rau Kokiri alongside some macadamia development and an irrigation scheme. At Te Kaha, they have obviously additional funding for an irrigation scheme up there, as well as additional kiwi fruit development. So they've already got 200 hectares of kiwi fruit development there. This is an additional 50 hectares. We've been working really closely with Whakatoia Wamo, which is Whakatoia Mussels Operating Limited and ODC, on the harbour project. And again, you know, what we've been able to achieve there has just been phenomenal. So not only has the harbour itself been funded, we've got the additional development through Whakatoia in the actual aquaculture space itself. Looking forward to Te Whanau Apanui are looking at doing additional aquaculture development there as well. And you may have seen a recent announcement around Te Kaha on some spat nursery, which again will help support that aquaculture development. In addition, there's been recent funding provided to the Peterson's block, which is where the industrial marina will go. And in addition, there is the funding for the mussel processing factory as well. And that will kick off from 1 July next year with 80 jobs. So this is a phenomenal investment in the Opotiki area. With Ngāti Awa, we've been working really closely on the Whakatāne Town Regeneration project, alongside the Boat Harbour projects as well. And all of that will underpin a growth in the marine industry. So we've got two of the key boat builders here in Awarohe, so Surtees and Extreme. So we've worked with them to actually bring forward and actually get them involved in a marine technical training centre, which is all about training the youth so that they can then be involved in that key industry going forward. And that's part of the development here in Whakatāne. We've also worked with Kawarau, so that's through Putuaki Trust, and KPID have got funding for container terminal, off-road highway, and also a key roundabout, which will then help them leverage that industrial area. We've worked with other people across the bay as well, mainly on how do they access water, and that's quite an interesting one because of my water background at BOPRC, where a lot of iwi and hapu who want to work on the land and want to develop the land, and they've struggled to understand how they can access water and where they can access water. So we've been helping the Mihana Koata Trust, and that's 17 hectares of blueberries out at Titiko. And we've also been helping up at Ruatoki B78 on how they can actually do some development on their land there as well. So I'll pass over to you, Carl, to talk about thriving communities.
Thanks, Ian. Well, I guess the only reason that we come to work and the reason that our board gives up their precious time is to create thriving communities across the Eastern Bay of Plenty. We are obviously in a situation where our statistics would show that our communities need a lot of support. One of the areas we focus on largely is in the workforce space. Just to give you some statistics as to what's happened in COVID, in 2019, July 2019, there were 1,981 unemployed in the Eastern Bay. Today, as a result of COVID, there are 2,666, so a significant increase. However, that number is still lower as a result of the efforts we've put in over the last 3 years, largely leveraging the Todd Foundation efforts. They've supported us significantly with funding in this workforce space. It is down from the 2018 numbers still. So we're trending right even in the face of COVID. With regards to Māori employment across the Eastern Bay and workforce development, we have gone this time last year from 1,580 to 2,086. So disproportionately, the Māori population across the Eastern Bay of Plenty has been impacted by COVID. Very, very sad. And rangatahi specifically, the age groups of 18 to 24 surged from 508 to 782. So it's very sad. We've pivoted all of our resources to support this in terms of workforce development. And we've just had 140 of our rangatahi go through a skills program through the driver operator training center located in Kawarau. But we've just had our first intake in Minganui. We actually took the course and took the forklifts, all of the apparatus that was required, into Minganui and held it out there locally. We also did that in Opotiki, and we'll talk a little bit more about the workforce development later because it's very important for all of us to understand. One of the things we have driven is our focus on making sure employers are also youth ready. That's the next phase of our development. In our program. So a thriving community needs a really, really high quality home. And the housing across the Eastern Bay is in crisis. It's the only way to describe it. We held a hui 3 weeks ago with iwi leaders, social providers. We had Kāinga Ora there, New Zealand there. And we've identified four work streams across the Eastern Bay of Plenty as our key priority. Firstly, is resolving the crisis we have today. That's working with Kāinga Ora. We're bringing forward as many of the 150 homes they already have on their books across the Arohi to build those as fast as possible and have a workforce development program underpinning those. We have a number of initiatives that are already underway. Toirie introduced the social developer to the Opotiki District Council that today is developing the homes in Opotiki in the old stockyards. So we've connected existing developers to help accelerate the resolution of the existing crisis. The second thing is having a spatial plan, long-term view of what it is we need to do across the Eastern Bay of Plenty, supply, demand. How do we build that picture of when we need the homes and where they're going to be? I'm hopeful that there will be some big announcements over the course of the coming weeks around some additional funding there. We announced our partnership with Kāinga Ora this week has deepened. They have announced they will be putting a further resource to support housing specifically for the Eastern Bay of Plenty to support Toirie's initiatives, which are largely focused on Māori communities in the Eastern Bay. So the other two aspects of our work streams that we agreed are addressing the quality crisis, making sure that we bring together all of those, and there are many goodwilled organisations out there today, especially funded by Bay Trust and Eastern Bay Energy Trust, around improving insulation requirements. And we've brought a separate work stream together on how all of those community organisations can collaborate and work together. And then the fourth piece is how we address, and I had a conference call today with the New Zealand team in Kāinga Ora, how we address the financing challenges of getting finance available to develop Māori land so that the land is never put at risk and is still able to be developed at a rate that meets the demand of the local communities here. So there's a lot of activity here. In that hui, we had the police, the DHBs, education, Ministry of Education. We had a lot of the social services, and we had representatives from the majority of our iwi stakeholders there as well as some hapu, such as in Raukokiri, which is facing an urgent crisis because of the development in kiwifruit that's happening down there. So we've been quite active on this, and it's one of the pieces that we've really put some gas behind in the last month. Ian, maybe you'd like to talk to your areas.
Yeah, so just another area we've been focusing in on, and it became really relevant through COVID, was the lack of digital connectivity in the Eastern Bay. You know, in rural New Zealand, we are so far behind as far as digital connectivity to our urban partners. So we've kicked off a project again in partnership. So we've got DHBs, we've got the police, we've got the social services providers, we've got iwi, and we've got education people at the table. And we're working on three key work streams in there. One is how do we actually fast track connectivity? So that's about people actually accessing the internet. So there's a lot of black spots in the Eastern Bay. Even when there isn't black spots, there's a lot of poor connectivity. So how do we actually try and drive that forward? So we've got a work stream that's going ahead around that. We've got a separate work stream working on affordability. So even when people do have connectivity, they can't afford it. And then we've got a third work stream, which is looking at devices and training. So there's lots of people providing devices but it's not very well joined up. So we're trying to actually try and come together with some coordinated approach on that. And not only when they get the devices, how do we train people within that as well? A lot of this is focused on youth, I will say to start with, because obviously we need to make sure that our youth have access to education, and certainly those people that don't have access to the internet start lagging behind in their education. So that's one of the key focuses for us just now.
So one of the areas that we obviously have all been impacted in quite significantly in Arohi is around COVID. And I'll just talk very quickly as to what happened there. The day, unfortunately, because of Whakaari, we already had a team up and running to respond to that. The Toirie team was asked by Whakatane District Council to manage the panel, to allocate the funds for all of the Whakaari recovery support. So we rolled that team together, and it was already a one facing team, which was both the Chamber of Commerce, Eastern Bay Chamber of Commerce, and the Toirie team. We took very simple steps. We wanted to keep the businesses that were deemed as essential alive and open and accessing all of the support and people, as well as PPE to keep them going. The second thing we did was make sure that we actually connected all of the people which needed support in the business community to stay alive while in hibernation. So we actually provided, within 2 weeks, we contacted over 300 organisations across the entire Eastern Bay of Plenty, from Ruatoki, Murupara, all the way through to Rau Kōkiri. We did that as we were on the fly, and we were actually commended by MB for our advanced state of preparedness and the way that we reacted. So we're now transitioning to recovery, and we continue to support through a number of courses that we're offering. We actually have just appointed, within the framework of the single entity of with the Chamber of Commerce, we've just appointed 2 people to go out and actually offer support in local communities, the business support they require, because it's all very well being in Whakatane where you have good peer-to-peer relationships to get the advice and support, but now we've actually got a roving mobile service that can go out, and that'll be starting up over the course of the next 3 weeks. So we're quite proud there. We have now got the database of over 1,000 businesses in the Eastern Bay of Plenty, which we're actively engaging with, and our Facebook page and the like is up and running and sending updates around the relevant business requirements and social requirements that these people may need, how to get support as fast as possible. Over to you, Ian.
So we're just going to show a picture. When we started the journey on the PGF, this was the kind of areas we were targeting. Things have moved on quite a lot since then, i.e. we've actually secured a lot of the funding for these projects. But I suppose just to flag that it's great that we've now got these projects in place. One of the key concerns is there's a significant amount of work to deliver against. It's great that we've got the funding, but we now need to actually deliver against this. And it's certainly in the Eastern Bay of Plenty, there's a lot of capacity and capability issues on delivering this. So one of the areas that TOIDI is looking at is how we can actually support the delivery of these projects that have actually funding against them. The next area that we will start looking at is going, so what's next? So I think regardless of the colour of the next government, I think there's cross-party support for some form of PGF going forward. What that looks like and what the focus is still to be defined. There's a lot of talk about the circular economy and low carbon economy, which is great. But so what we'll start doing is probably start turning our attention to what's next in PGF 2.0. How do we leverage, for example, the geothermal at Kawerau? We are being contacted already about from some manufacturing companies. So there was a processing factory being discussed at Opotiki. Now, as soon as people mention processing factories, that's great because it's continuous jobs. So we're actually working with a group of people on how that can actually be then delivered in Opotiki. Remembering that Te Whanau Apanui, so their average wage in the East Coast is 16,500. So how do we actually try and lift some of those statistics around average wages up? And I think that's how we can actually focus in on how do we deliver good jobs to actually help with that.
So in terms of our workforce development strategy, we've been very, very focused, as I said, on relevancy to our rangatahi. Those are largely in link-up and licensed to work programs together with schools. We've partnered very closely there. Last year, we had 9 sites that we worked directly with and had 93 participants with 36 people certified as a result. That came as a result of Bay Education Trust funding and Todd Foundation funding. We've done video resourcing to connect with rangatahi across the board in ways that they want to be talked to or engaged with. We work directly with NZKGI to deliver the Cultivate Your Career Day, where 80 Eastern Bay students learnt about their opportunities within the horticulture sector. As Ian mentioned, horticulture is one of the key 4 areas of activity across the region, and we need to make sure that happens cohesively. We've spent a lot of time trying to work through Class 1 driver licensing. And it's not just so that people are work ready, but also so that the first engagement with the law doesn't spiral out of control. Most of the times that people first engage with the police is when they are driving a vehicle unlicensed or unregistered. So that's very important for us as well. We also have a good granular understanding now of the workforce and where we're going. We continue to build a view of the pipeline. It informs the Regional Skills Leadership Group. We are lucky that we have our chair representing the TOEDA board's view and TOEDA's view on what we need in terms of skill development. We actually have myself and Toi Ohomai have co-developed the program for the Marine Technical Training Centre to be held in Whakatane. That's getting up and running before the Ngāti Awa Workforce Development Program is actually underway. We haven't waited, and I speak to Leon on almost a weekly basis, the CEO of Toi Ohomai, to try to have made this happen. They had to bend some rules for us. We also work very closely with Wiramu around making sure that the Te Awa Nui Aorangi focus is not only focused on the community, but also takes into consideration the needs of our business community as well, because it's ultimately them that are going to be employing the rangatahi that are coming through the programs. That's how we've identified gaps and we've found ways to overcome them. So we've worked very closely with a lot of the local level initiatives. We have a steering group over the top, which is our Workforce Development Advisory Board. And the reason that was started up was because there were pockets of excellence in Kawarau and Oporiki, even Murupara, lots of school initiatives, and we bring them together into one cohesive framework. Now, our objective with the PGF funding is to create 7,000 jobs over the next 7 years. That's a lot of jobs in a region which has 50,000 people. So that's why working directly with the sector leaders to understand what it is they really need in terms of skill development is key to us. So Ian, maybe.
Thanks, Carl. So I'll just briefly talk about our driver and operator training center at Kawarau. So this was put in place with MB funding last year. It's in place for 2 years initially, and we will look to try and prove this as a commercial model and then hand it over as a commercial proposition to carry on. As Carl mentioned earlier, over the last 12 months, well, it's not quite been 12 months, we've had 140 students go through already. We currently have around 40 to 50 students going through currently. And the types of courses that they are doing are, you'll see the forklift there. We do working at heights with scaffolding. We do working at confined spaces. We've got courses on logistics, we've got courses on wheel tracks and rollers, and we also have courses for driver licensing for trucks. So that's the key courses that we have in place. We've had good numbers come through. Currently, we're tracking around 80% capacity for the facilities itself. Carl mentioned that we're starting to take projects and training out to other areas. So we ran a two-day forklift training course, and that's worked extremely well for that two-day course. We're also looking at taking other courses through to Whakatane, working with Te Puna Oro Matatoa, and also we're working with Oporiki. So we've got funding to actually help with both pastoral care and also transport to the centre. And what we're actually putting in place is actually support for people to come from across the Eastern Bay into the centre. And we're running a hub and spoke model where we're actually taking the actual courses out to the relevant areas and then just doing the practical components back at Kawarau. So that's working extremely well. We're also working with MSD, so we're doing courses as a result of COVID, quite a lot of short courses with them. And we're also working with corrections. And corrections are using that facility as well for doing some training for those incarcerated. So that's working extremely well.
Sorry. Oh, sorry, guys, it's not...
Sorry, we're just trying to get onto our last slide.
Sorry, guys.
That's okay. We can
talk talk to that without it. Look, largely it's been pre-circulated. So there we go. Thank you. At the end of the day, our approach is not to work in isolation. We have spent 99% of our time dealing with Māori organisations, because at the end of the day, the Eastern Bay of Plenty is uniquely uniquely made up of a very rich cultural diversity through all of the different iwi and hapu organisations. I myself am on Ngāti Awa's group holdings board, for example. I speak most days, and I think Ian would speak most days, with different hapu or iwi leaders around their needs, so that what we do is tailor them. We have to tailor their needs and translate them often into the central government and local government entities. And I would say that we have very good relationships now ongoing across the local community. We don't try to do things by ourselves. And that's the key difference, I think, from where we are today to where we were just 12 months ago. We try to identify gaps and fill the gaps if no one else is willing to fill them. And where there are people which are willing partners, we will sit alongside them and support them to accelerate their plans. So, yeah.
I think just to finish, just from me, so there was a couple of questions asked earlier on about what issues we're seeing. So certainly in the Eastern Bay, there's a significant amount of PGF and other ministry funding coming in. There is a lack of understanding of exactly where that pipeline will be landing and when, and what skills are needed to support that. I mean, we're talking 7,000 jobs here, or, you know, significant amount of jobs, but no one person has that view. So we're working with Robert Pigol, who's the CEO of the PDU, to try and seek some funding so we can actually look at how do we actually develop a pipeline for the Eastern Bay and keep it live. So that's one of the issues that we're seeing. And one of the key reasons is our businesses need certainty. They're the ones that are employing people, no one else. So we need to really actually provide that certainty to them so that they can actually see what's coming. So I run a civil construction sector meeting, and they're really concerned between October and March, because they're going, there's no way we can deliver all of that. But we don't know what's happening after March. So they're really concerned around the pipeline, about A, being able to deliver it because of the volume, but B, going, if we do this, we'll bring a whole bunch of big players in from Auckland, and we won't be able to deliver against this, and then we'll get squeezed out. So there is some concerns there, but we've got plans in place to try and address that.
Ka pai, kia ora kōrua. Thank you for your presentation, and you've certainly been busy over the last 12 months, and in an incredibly dynamic space. So tēnā kōrua, congratulations on the value that you have been able to bring to the many partners that you have worked with regards to getting some of those bids across the line. I know you have been working, the feedback I've heard is that you've been working very hard with some of those partners, but you did go over time. Aroha mai. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite Toi Kairawa to give their presentation. At the end of that, we'll see how much time we've got left for question time. And we'll do that together. Kei te pai, kōrua.
Kia ora.
Ka pai, thank you. Okay, so we have Tamarapa Lloyd and Awhina Ngātuere from Toi Kairawa, who is an organisation that the Bay of Plenty Regional Council is supporting and resourcing to bring a clearer picture for us in terms of the economic development space across the whole Toi Moana, across the whole region. Tēnā kōrua, kei kuna kōrua.
Aira, kia ora.
Kia ora, kei a kōrua, tēnā koe. Tamarapa.
Ai, e te tī, e te tā, no te wī, no te wā. Tēnei te mihi ki a koutou katoa, me ki rā tēnei uri o Te Arawa, o Ngāti Tuwhare Toa, e mihi kau atu ana ki a koutou katoa, te komiti Māori. Tuatahi, mākura e tuku i ngā whakaro ki a tātou tēne maite, kua huhua i rungi ngā marae maha. O tī rā ki a koutou, nā kānohi ora o rātou, koutou kua tākoha mai, koutou kua tukana hei pūtia, me ki rā mā wērā ka rere tēnei manu, Nō reira, ngā mihi kia koutou nō te komiti Māori, koutou e tautoko mai nei. Kia ora everyone, my name's Tamarapa, I'm the chair of Toi Kairawa. I've been joined by Awhina, who's our GM. Firstly, I'd like to say a big thank you to the Komiti Māori for supporting Toi Kairawa in our endeavours. I've got a fairly pared back kind of presentation. I'm just conscious of time, so we can trim it right back. I think the committee's fairly familiar with the proposition of Toi Kairawa. What I might do though is see if I can share my screen for the benefit of those of you that might not have. So I'll just quickly
Tamarapa, I'll just say that you know, do your presentation. We do have time. I've got some time in here, and okay. Haere tonu. There are a lot of people here who haven't on the line, who haven't heard about you. So,
Kia ora. Okay, so this is who we are, Toi Kairawa. We're a charitable trust, and I guess our kaupapa was, after being involved in this space for a long time as an advisory committee called He Mauri Ohooho for the last 7.5-8 years, we decided that the timing was right for us to come out and form ourselves up as our own entity to try and advance Māori economic development in the Bay of Plenty. And we chose the name Toi Kairawa, obviously, given the kind of central importance of Toi Te Huatahi, but also the notion of kairawa, of abundance. So I guess this brief timeline sort of shows our genesis really, which is that we've been in this for a really long time, but we've really only just stepped out from underneath of the Bay of Connections to become our own standalone entity. But many of the people that are on our board have been involved and in this space for a long time. So our kaupapa is about connecting our people, making sure that we're healthy, that we're thriving as a community, that we're thriving in a Māori way and succeeding as Māori. So I'll just move through who our board of trustees are. And many of these people will be known to people on this Zui. Te Horipo Karaitiana, who's been in the primary agri space for many years. He's currently at Te Awanui Hukapak. He's also involved in FOMA, and has been involved in FOMA for many years. He's on Wairarapa, the board of Wairarapa Moana and a few other big boards. Dr. Marwi Hudson, who's an academic and researcher, he's very prominent in the data sovereignty movement at the moment, and is leading a lot of really good kōrero between the Crown and Māori and the Crown and government agencies around the way that our data is being utilised. Kirirua Savage, he was formerly with Westpac Bank, now he's with GHA. He's got a consulting and public sector background, but also has deep expertise in the geothermal sector. Tānira Kingi, big primary sector background, he's also on a number of trusts and corporations. Anthony Olson, who's also on the board of Toi EDA, has been with us for many years. Dr. Liddy Ellis, our sole wahine Māori, we are looking at addressing that. Whānau, we've got our ringaringa out at the moment, and a couple of expressions of interest that we're working through. So Dr. Liddy Ellis is from Tauranga Moana. She's leading a couple of the metal ventures that the previous presenters spoke about. She's also got an academic background, and rounding us out is Richard Jeffries, who's now based in Opotiki. In terms of regional context, I guess just to kind of set the scene, right? So we are a youthful population, and it's really that youthful cohort that occupies a lot of our time and a lot of our strategic thinking, particularly when we bear in mind the billions of dollars that we're taking on at the moment at a national level to try and stimulate our way through the COVID recovery. It's these young people that will be the taxpayers of the future. And it's really these young people that we need to make sure are in gainful employment, that are in well-paid employment, that are exporting our products to the world to ensure that we have a tax base to pay back those millions of dollars that we're currently drawing down. 20% of our Māori youth are unemployed, and you know, our previous speakers have already talked about the impact of COVID on our Māori unemployment numbers. It's also something of a double whammy for us in that it's also impacting our wahine Māori. So when we think about the types of jobs that have been impacted in the tourism and in the retail sector, they tend to be gender-specific roles, in that we find that there are a lot of wahine that are employed in those positions. And so you almost get this kind of double whammy effect where in some households, the sole earner is also the sole parent. And then we've got a 25% increase in the number of Māori in the skilled workforce since 2012. So things are moving in the right direction. When we look at our asset classes, we own a lot of capital heavy assets, 40% in forestry, lots in fishing and quota, lamb production, sheep and beef production, dairy and kiwi fruit. 38% of the Waiata Bay of Plenty land is owned by Māori. And in fact, our region has the highest number of Māori land trusts and incorporations of any region in the country. And we've got a kind of growing Māori business network, albeit that it's slightly disaggregated and that we don't have this kind of bay-wide umbrella that captures everyone. And I guess I think this most recent kind of COVID pandemic has also shown us that we don't have a national structure either that can advocate for and on behalf of Māori SMEs. Toi Kaidawa, we've got four strategic priority areas. So Whenua Order, which looks at unlocking the potential of Māori land and water ecosystems. Tangata Order, unlocking the potential of our Māori communities. Rangatahi Order, mobilising the future Māori workforce by connecting young people to high value opportunities. And Pākehi Order, energising and mobilising our Māori business work network. And why do we do that? Kia mauri ora ai, ne? Kia piki te ora o a tātou, o tātou anai Māori. Look, I don't think we need to go into pre and post COVID in any more detail, except to say that regionally, I guess the big numbers are 30% of our Māori households are doing okay, 30% are the working poor, and 30% are welfare reliant. And it's really that those working poor that that we need to be most concerned about, and that the tipping point for them to go into being welfare reliant for many has probably already been hit. So we've got some key priorities that we're looking at based around our four order with a number of key enablers that we see underpinning that. And those are bespoke workforce development solutions. So designing solutions for the gaps where we can see that there is demand, where we can see that there is not only national but also international potential. For example, in geothermal, where there's hardly enough geothermal scientists, engineers, internationally, let alone nationally. If we think about what we've been through most recently during level 4 lockdown, building the level of digital resilience in our regional economies is incredibly important. When you look at those
industries that managed to get through COVID level 4 lockdown relatively unscathed, they were all digitally enabled. So those businesses that had digital sales channels sold far outstripped those that relied on people turning up through the front doors of their shops, of their businesses in order to sell. So thinking hard about how we can build digital strategies to increase both access and literacy for our communities, but also how we can enable digital solutions for a more resilient region. Activation of Māori business ecosystems. There are a number of small Māori business networks. A lot of really passionate people involved, but they're not joined up and they're not resourced from the centre in order to provide the level of advocacy that you see for Pākehā businesses. There's a growing potential for social procurement, which is largely rolling out from the centre. Unfortunately, due to the nature of elections and politics, seems like the announcement of that wonderful proposition has been delayed until probably post-election. But nevertheless, there are many councils and organisations that are pushing ahead with social procurement, regardless of an announcement coming out from the centre. Activation of inter-trade and trade services. Under Māori Land, we're looking at an annual Whenua Māori Innovation Summit, which will probably occur sometime in early next year, given the likelihood of us bouncing in and out of COVID lockdown levels. And a Whenua Māori Solutions Hub. In terms of rangatahi, we've got a very heavy focus here around the STEAM approach, which is science, technology, English, arts, and mathematics. So we run a number of discovery tours, particularly in the geothermal space, to try and build the number of rangatahi that are interested in moving into geothermal as an area of activity. Hubs for cadetships, internships, and scholarships. So we've got our digital hubs in terms of providing particular skills. So our relationship with the Electric Gardens, with Spark, and Microsoft International Charitable Trust, together with a couple of PGF applications that are a work in progress at the moment, but are really centered around digital. So our focus for 2020, we're gonna deploy our strategy and action plans, we'll connect to what works, we'll collaborate to build partnerships, we'll reach out to our Indigenous whānau to draw on what works internationally, coordinate for scale and for leverage, and design into the gaps. So that's, I guess, our sort of overall approach. Ka pai, I'm just gonna quickly see if we can hit some of these questions. Yes, correct, diversity is happening. It's on its way. We haven't been paying our trustees, so you know, this is, Our mahi is all for aroha. And so we just need to find the right people to come onto the board for that type of value proposition. And we've got a couple of really exciting people.
Ka pai, tamarapa, should I open the floor up for questions?
Yep. Ka pai.
Kia ora tamarapa, tēnā koe e hua. Mo tērā whakamārama kia mātou. I will open it up to questions on the floor for both Toi EDA and Toi Kairawa. First of all, we have questions from, we have some in the chat, which I'll come back to, but we have a question on the floor from Mate Moana, Councillor McDonald. Tēnā koe, Mate Moana.
Aroha mai e hoa. I think my hand was for the previous presentation, so I'll just pass. I do have a question, but I'll get behind the queue.
Okay, get the bite. Councillor White, tenakui.
My first question really is to our Toi EDA people. I was pleased to see the last slide because, first let me say $450 million for Eastern Bay, well overdue, well deserved, and congratulations to everybody involved. You know, it's heartening to see our people in the Eastern Bay with some uplift, you know, that in many ways has not been there. So good on them. So I guess, you know, as I listened to your presentation, it was really, really detailed, and thank you. And it posed a lot of issues around how much work is being done. And my first thought, well, you guys never sleep. Right? But then I heard the comment that, you know, we have pulled this money in, we are doing this, we are doing that. And I was pleased to see the last slide, which showed the composite of contributions, which I think then brings it back into the reality that it's connected and collective and that the iwi are involved. So I just wanted to make that comment, and I was going to pose it as a question, who was the we? But now I understand who the we is. So thank you.
Kia ora te taro. Thank you. We do sleep. But we actually have a day and a half a week each in terms of our funding. So we aren't exactly resource rich. Everyone that does provide the support though. Just on that, so the four catalytic projects, it's very, very simple in the way that we look at it. High value horticulture, that's largely the support to whanapanui and Ngāti Awa's aspirations moving underutilized land up the value chain. And we sat inside the tent with them to develop their applications. So with Rau Kōkiri's application, for example, we sat in the tent trying to build an investment plan. With the Miro Berries, we help them build that application. With regards to the Ngāti Awa application, I actually personally led the one of the work streams around the marine sector. And it's all about getting inside and collaborating and filling the gaps and capacity and capability that they had. With Whakatohia, it was great that we already had Whakatohia muscles and the executive team driving that. But we helped a lot on the harbour side of things to make sure that there wasn't a bridge to nowhere, but also the assets were appropriately funded. And when it comes to the Putuaki Trust, Kawarau Industrial Development, they were well advanced in that. And we supported them, but we didn't do as much as the other areas. We really worked closely with, for example, I went to Rotorua twice with Maramena to do the work for life application and rescope it that they were doing with the Murupara Rangatahi focus. So, you know, we've got alongside, and we certainly haven't owned anything really, except we've connected the right people, and that's what our mahi's been. We're focused on that.
Kia ora, thank you for that. Just one quick follow-up to both of you, the Toi Kaiarawa and Toi EDA. You're both playing a role. One's regional focus, the other one's focused mostly on the Eastern Bay. How is that working in? Can I ask you both?
Look, I'll lead there, Afina, if that's okay with you. I spoke with Afina just ahead of this conversation. We speak quite regularly, just staying ahead of the game to make sure that we are maximising the areas of focus. I think as Toi Kairawa's plans roll out across the Eastern Bay of Plenty, we'll have a lot more to do with it. And we, just like I said, we can't do this alone. And we're very, very, scarcely funded is probably the best way to put it. So we welcome anyone that is like-minded and wants to collaborate and connect. And I know that Afina's been very gracious like that too.
Tēnā tātai. Can you hear me, Ihuama? Is it good?
Aye.
Ka pai. Kei te tautoko i ngā mihi kua mihia. Mōku noi hoa.
No, you're breaking up there, Afina. Maybe if you turn your camera off. If Tamarapa could jump in there, maybe, because I don't think his connection is good.
Ka pai. Yeah, so we are, it's still kind of early days, right? We kicked off in January. I know Aifina's working in with Carl and the team, probably more at the foundational level to share kōrero and approach. I think Te Taru, you probably rightly identified the ambit of our responsibilities goes a bit broader than to a specific geography. So we're sort of all of Bay from the west to the east and down to the south as well. So we do have a fairly kind of broad geography that we need to cover. It's interesting, right, because some of the challenges that we've identified in terms of the rationale for the establishment of Toi Kairaua have also been shared by other people in the same space. So we've got the Wellington Regional Council now picking up on our approach and looking to develop an initiative very similar to Toi Kairaua.
Kia ora tamarapa. Okay, we have, before I go on to the Councillor Rose, there was a question here from Hariana Rupapira to the Toi Kairaua, the Toi EDA team. Just a question, a clarification of the 7,000 jobs, over what time period was that again? And also asking, what is your interpretation of the meaning of the word rangatahi? So I'll hand that over to you, Carl and Ian.
So really the 7,000 jobs were profiled over and up to 2030. So it's over the next 10 years. So that's the kind of profile that was prepared for the PGF application. So by 2030, we're expecting 7,000 additional jobs, of which I would say it's around 4,500 directs. And then we've got indirect jobs as a result of that as well. So that's the kind of timing profile. As far as rangatahi, so really that's the youth. So so within our MB contract that we've got, that's from the ages of 16 to 24. But you know, a lot of what we do actually expands beyond that as well. So although that might be the focus, we are looking at all the unemployed in the area and how do we actually try and get them back into valuable jobs.
So the specifics around those statistics that I mentioned from the comparison of 2019 to 20, that was for youth below the age of 24.
Okay, ka pai. Hopefully that answers her question. I'm now going to pass it over to Councillor Rose, who has a pātai. Got a Stacey.
Ka pai ihoa. My questions to both organisations, and it's good to see you, Tamarapa, again, and Carl and Ian, good to see you guys as well. Look, there's been a lot of talk about rangatahi. There's been a lot of talk about young people, but my big thing is, are we ensuring we're looking at all rangatahi Māori, not just the ones that are sitting in this area, but we're making sure we're looking at all rangatahi Māori? Because the thing is that a lot of the time people are talking about looking at rangatahi and they look at a small little gap. Whereas for me, I want to be able to know that the mahi that you guys, that both Toi EDA and Toi Kairaua are doing, are looking at all rangatahi Māori, not just a small little gap of rangatahi Māori. So can you tell me if you're looking at a small gap or if you're looking at a much wider perspective of rangatahi Māori?
Look, so certainly from a Toi EDA perspective, it's the wider rangatahi that we're looking at. But it's interesting, actually, more recently as part of our funding request that's coming through the for the MB funding, we're being asked to look at not only Rangatahi 18 to 24, but it's actually expanding to beyond that, which is great because we started before COVID with a significant unemployment. So we need to kind of look at all of those unemployed, not just Rangatahi, but certainly to answer your question, it's the broad Rangatahi that we're focused on. But now we're starting to see a lot more funding coming in for all unemployed, which is great as well.
Kia ora kōrua. We're just going to have to bring it to a close in a minute. I do have one final question from Councillor Thurston from the Rotorua district. Kia ora.
And tēnā koe to you in particular. It's been brilliantly chaired. And can I say, I'm pretty sure my colleagues agree, there have been some phenomenal presentations today. And it's just a shame that more people didn't get a chance to actually watch them. But tēnā koe to you, Tamarapa. You know, you and I go back a long way. And I was one of the Pākehās on the Committee Māori who pushed long and hard in support of Tuikai Rawa. And look, I'm the first to say it's early days yet, but I think I speak for all of us, and particularly the Pākehās on this team, that, you know, what's good for Māori and Māori development is good for the whole region. So, no, you have our full support there, my friend. And no, we were honoured to get in behind Mati Moana and her two gentlemen friends, and to push like hell on this one. So no, we got there in the end. It was incredibly political, but we got the numbers and we swung our colleagues around. But I just repeat, you know, what's good for Māori economic development for the Bay of Plenty in my eyes is good for the region. Kia ora.
Ka pai. Kia ora, Councillor Thurston. I think that's a great note to end this particular part of our hui today. And he mihi tēnei kia koe Lyle. Yes, this is a team sport, and it is great to, and that's what I, you know, looking at Kyle and Ian and Tamarapa and Awhina, we are, you know, largely a bicultural society, and we're bringing together Māori and Pākehā on this journey, and it's going to take all of us batting on for the same team. So, tēnā koe, Councillor Thurston, and tēnā koutou, Ian, Kyle, Tamarapa and Awhina for your presentations this morning. Thank you. Okay, so we're heading for the home straight, koutou mā. I have the Committee Māori Chair report, which has been tabled. I will take that as read. Could I please have a mover and a seconder for that report? Kia ora Paula, moving, and Councillor Clark, second. All for, against, carried. Kia ora. Okay, so I'm going to now pass it on to our staff member, Katarina Belshaw, to introduce an exciting kaupapa. Oh, O'Brien, aroha mai. Aroha mai. Kei a koe, Katarina.
Kia ora anō koutou. Just my pleasure to introduce a couple of the students that received our recent Tuka Tūmoana scholarship, and that scholarship is an environmental scholarship for students studying Taiao studies in the Bay of Plenty and contributing to our beautiful environment here. So we have some students on standby, and they are going to briefly introduce themselves and just also briefly explain what they are studying, because some of the work they're doing is absolutely stunning. These are our rangatahi coming through, our next generation of kaitiaki, and they feel very privileged to receive the scholarship. So the scholarship is a $10,000 annual scholarship. What we did, usually we award 4 scholarships at $2,500, but the calibre was so high this year that we thought we should spread it out, give more out to the students and just enable more people to get some financial contribution. And they were all really happy with that. They're very humble students. So we awarded 10 students $1,000 to contribute to their studies and their research. So we have here Harina Rupapira, we've got Wakapō, Althea Hukurua, Siobhan Nuri and Tirua Wallace. So they will just briefly have a kōrero to you all, and we'll start with Harina, please. Kia ora.
Well, tēnā tātou, the host is not allowing my camera to turn on. However, piki mai kake mai raho mai te wai ora ki ahau. Papa ki tūana ngātai ki te reinga ka pō, ka ao, ka ao atea. Ko rangi tihi, ko rangi aohia, ko mahi, ko rongo mai, ko te apiti, ko te rangi whakatara, ko rohi, ko te whareiti, ko tioga, ko moko nui ārangi, ko pairau, ko tānira, ko raureti pairau moko nui ārangi, ka puta ko te whainoa, nāna ko Irene, koia tōku kuia, nāna ko Renei, ka moia Renei ke Aaron Rupapira a ko au. Tēnei, ko Harina Rinaha Rupapira, tēnei a Ngāti Rangi Tihi e mihi kauana ki a koutou, mō tō koutou tautoko, tō koutou āwhina, me tō koutou āwhina, ata whai mai ki ōku mahi whare wānanga o tira ki tōku oranga tonutanga. Oh, there we go. Yeah, did everyone catch that? Was it on mute?
All good.
Tēnā tātou, he uri au no Ngāti Rangitihi. I just wanted to thank you so much for supporting my studies. I've nearly finished my Masters of Applied Indigenous Knowledge and just planning the stages of my PhD to do with the nutritional benefits of the Kumara STEM, and also it'll be a PhD in the science, so showing our mātauranga Māori the migration of the Kumara, and the adaption of the knowledge through climate that our ancestors is just truly amazing, and they had that ability way before Western science, and so it'll be from the likes of Machu Picchu all the way through the islands to now. And I'm a Kumara, well, gardener perhaps, with Kairotorua committee. Yeah, so just thank you so much. I'm really passionate about Taiao. I'm with the environmental team with Te Aroa Lakes, and I'm also a newly science researcher with SCIOM. And I'm the Te Aroa Parakore advisor. So if anyone needs any more information on any of those things, whakapā mai. Mauri ora.
Awesome. Harina, thank you very much. That's fabulous. Awesome. Our next student is Wakapō. Waka, kei kona, koe?
Aira, can you hear me?
Ai.
Kia ora tātou, ko Wakapō tōku ingoa. E uri whakaheke tēnei o Ngāti Awa, o Ngāti Mapare, o Ngāti Whakaihamo. Nā reira, kei te mihi ki a koutou katoa. I am currently completing my master's thesis in anthropology at Te Whare Wānanga o Waikato, under the supervision of Dr. Fiona McCormack, with Dr. Kura Paul Burke as my cultural advisor. My thesis looks at the kina barons of Mutunui Plate Island, aiming to discover whether the meanings we give to kina and the multiple ways we relate to them are changing as a result of both the presence of barons and our impact as humans on the environment. So this includes discovering the history of kina around Mutunui and looking at the movement, increase or decrease of certain species such as kina, pāmure, kaura and humans. So I also touch on the stories of Ngāti Whakahemo with Motino's underwater environment and Motino's inclusion as a Motiti protection area. And I've got a question for anyone. If anyone has the whakapapa of kina, whether it relates to Rangawha or Kiwa and Henewana, please hit me up, because there's heaps of kōrero out there on the whakapapa of toka or whike haeharane. And lastly, I'd like to thank Bay Plenty Regional Council for accepting me and supporting my research. Kia ora.
Oh, karawe koe tō kōrero, Waka. Okay, you can ask the students questions after we've heard from them all, if that's all right. So the next one we've got is Ms. Higurua. Are you there? Okay, maybe we'll go to Siobhan first, Siobhan Nuri.
I'm Siobhan. I'm studying my master's on ecology and biodiversity on the Rangitaiki River, looking at the recruitment of glass eels and how different environmental variables contribute to how or when they come in or how often they come up. And it's been a real awesome project. We've had a school come down and some teachers, and we get a lot of local help, which we're real thankful for. And I just want to say thank you very much for the scholarship and supporting me with my studies.
That's excellent. Thank you. And some of us have been down to Rangitaiki to help our students with their work there. And they work tirelessly through all weathers. And we also, I've been out there a couple of times just to have a nohi nohi at what they're doing, because the Rangitaiki, of course, is a river in my pepeha, so I'm very interested in what goes on there. But they do all hours into the night, all weather, doing this study, which hopefully will contribute to our mātauranga of the river. So kia ora, thank you very much for that, Ihua. And we've got a Althea Hukurua. Are you here? Is she online? She is trying to join this meeting, so perhaps we could just see if there's any questions for the students. Is that all right, Mr. Chair?
Ka pai, whakaro pai tērā, Katarana. Any pātai from the floor? Let me just see if there's any hands raised yet. We have a couple. Te Taru, Councillor White, kei a koe.
Yeah, kia ora, ngam hiki a koutou, ngā tauira. Yeah, he pai ana ho koutou, whakaro koutou kōrero, koutou mahi. Hey, look, just a comment, Mr. Chair. We've heard a lot about, the need for the next generation, the ones that are going to be paying the tax on the heavy debts that we're encumbering right now. We've got the worries of the Raukumara and other environmental impacts upon us, climate change heading. As an older fella now in the gold card territory, I have to say that I'm really, 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 really pleased to see hear these conversations and see how well our younger people are going to be doing as successions to the leadership of our people. So, hey, look, congratulations to you all. I've got no questions, just a comment that I think is superb. Kia ora.
Ka pai, kia ora te taru, he tika tō kōrero e hua. I will pass it over to Councillor MacDonald. Tēnā koe, matamona.
Kia ora koutou, ngā tauira. Hey, I'm very similar comments really to Te Taru. He beat me out the gate. Look, it's really exciting to see what our rangatahi are doing. And I see that the budget that we've allowed for this is $10,000. I think, I think it's a kōrero that needs to go to part of our LTP discussion. And I think we need to be contributing more in the space. Because having our rangatahi train in these specialist areas, at the end of the day, helps to build the capacity and capability of Māori. So I would like to see further consideration taken in our LTP planning around extending the budget for this particular scholarship. Kia ora.
Kia ora, Councillor MacDonald. Ka pai. I see that's noted. Passing the rock over to Councillor Rose.
Kia ora koutou to my fellow rangatahi. Look, it's great to see other rangatahi actually stepping out and actually taking on these opportunities. I want to say well done to you guys, well done to the others who have done this as well. But really, now it's about looking into your research, doing really well, and then in 10, 20 years, remembering back and going, oh yeah, I remember that. I remember getting those funds. Because the thing is that for me, it is actually so awesome to see our rangatahi stepping up, taking that next step that's gonna help with their journey and help with all of that. So I wanna say well done, guys. and ladies, well done. Keep it up. And I look forward to hearing about the rest of your studies and all in the future. And I look forward to seeing you as future leaders of our rohe. So well done, team.
Got it, Councillor Rose. We have one of our remaining students on the line now. I'm just going to pass it back to you, Katarana.
Yes, so we've got Miss Hukurua, the lucky last. Thank you for joining us. The floor is yours.
There we are. Kia ora koutou. Sorry, I was a little bit late this morning. I had a few little hiccups with the Zoom link there, but we got there in the end. Firstly, I would just like to thank you for this opportunity to meet you all and for the scholarship. It has contributed to my studies, so that's very good, thank you. I am studying the Bachelor's of Environment Planning in Te Ara Taiao at Waikato University. So that mostly is focused on the planning degree, but with a key focus on Mātauranga Māori and yeah. do you have any questions you would like to ask me, or I don't really know.
Oh, kia ora. Kia ora. Kia ora. That was lovely, and I know it's a bit nerve-wracking being on Zoom with all these high-powered councillors and rangatira. Yes. So thank you for joining us, and believe you me, when we read through all the applications, they're absolutely stunning. So and perhaps if we did extend our scholarship, we could have provide support to more students.
Yes.
So kia ora koutou. Thank you very much. Wonderful.
Kia ora Katarina, and thank you and congratulations to all of the recipients of He Toka Tū Moana. What a positive way.
Toi kai rākau, aroha tū.
Yeah.
I don't know the process, so I'm just asking now, because I was at the last tui, because I lead the youth initiative from Te Aroha Lakes Trust, and I asked for the letter of support, and then after the hui, I was told that actually they didn't move the motion, even though we all said aye in the hui, remember? Matuataru. So I'm asking now, if it's appropriate, can we just move the motion to have that letter of support for that presentation, the initiative that I shared at the last hui at Te Takinga?
Kia ora, Te Taru. I'm just looking over at our governance team here to get some advice on that harina. Paihua, kua. Yeah, kapai. Yeah, so I've been told, no problem, we can get a letter of support. We don't have to pass it through to Committee Māori to grant that letter of support and to action it. So I've been told by staff that you will see that letter of support coming to you. Hit the pipe.
Thank you so much. Tēnā koutou katoa.
Bold tēnā koe.
Harina, kapai.
yeah, get on in there. That's right. Utilise the machine, the mechanics of the Toi Moana. Hey, tēnā koutou katoa. Yes, as I was saying, there was a beautiful way to bring our hui to a close. But I would like to open, before we do close, open the floor up. We've discussed a lot of kaupapa, from Te Rau Kumara Pai Maunga project, and those challenges that are ahead of us. When we look at that, that's a huge challenge. But what I've taken away is the optimism as we face climate change, as we face the degradation of our biodiversity. We are still coming together to find ways forward. You know, there's a lesson coming out of COVID even. And so when we're faced with these huge challenges, that it's amazing how it actually can bring us together. So with that whakaaro, I'd like to open up the floor to any pātai before we close, or any closing statements from anybody. Tēnā koutou. Is that your hand still up, Councillor White?
Yeah, look, I just want to reflect on the comment that Wooda has just made. Maybe you can read it out, because Wooda can't actually get his sound going at the other end, I think.
Oh, yes. So from Tā Wooda Gardner, this is why the series of hui must continue to share positive news and to share learnings. This is an abundance of naysayers who will tell us why things can't happen. But this morning has been Mickey, which is too Mickey, which is too much. So tēnā koe tā wera mō tērā. Yes, it's true. And I think it's fantastic that we have this opportunity to showcase what is happening in Te Ao Māori, the way that we are finding solutions to meet the challenges that we have in front of us, and especially for our councillors who are viewing from the Western Bay to see what's happening over here in the Eastern Bay, and the kinds of initiatives that are coming from the grassroots, the solutions that iwi, whānau, hapū are finding, and the way that they are finding opportunities to partner with not only local government, but with the Crown and with each other to find a way to provide oranga for the next generation, because that is our responsibility. Yep, so,
Sorry, Toi. I'm going to say my last words and then shut my waha. Hey, look. I just want to say that, you know, it is exciting to see this, but there's a reality check as well. We're in for a long tail in this COVID-19, but, you know, what I'm heartened by is the resilience and the hope and aspirations that our people are expressing today. You know, this isn't dreamland stuff. This is stuff that we need to do. And like Wooda, we need to get behind and back this. We need to get behind and back our next generation. I agree with what Mate Moana was suggesting here, that these scholarships and these cadetships are important in that. You know, to give our young people the voice, and I really, really applaud that. And look, I personally, I'm really enthused by the quality of presentations today, the conversations, and I guess the heart and soul that people are bringing into making a difference in the change. So with that, ngā mihi ki a koutou, all of you who have participated today. So that's me signing out. Kia ora.
Kia ora, Councillor White. Councillor McDonald.
Kia ora koutou. Ngā mihi ki a koutou. Excellent hui today, Mr. Chair. Through you, I just want to suggest, because it was quite an information-packed hui this morning, and there are going to be implications for us with the LTP. Through you, Mr. Chair, I would like to suggest that we have our staff who are present coordinate a debrief for the members of Committee Māori, for us to have a debrief session following this hui. Anytime we're available this week would be good, so that we can actually sit down and have more kōrero about the presentations that we heard today. Kia ora.
Apai, I've gotten the nod from the team over here, so look for that invite in your calendar. Apai. Anybody else like to raise their hands? Final words? Maru tips. Maybe turn your mic on. I can't see. Oh, yeah,
koe nā.
Ka pai.
Kia ora matua. Yeah, well, tēnā koutou rā. I listened to the presentations quite contently, and I was impressed with the first presentation and the kairawa presentation. But I would just simply sum it up as there's a difference between taking Mohammed to the mountain and the mountain to Mohammed. There's a slight difference. We've got to get identify who goes to the mountain. Is it Mohammed or does the mountain have to go to Mohammed? And of course, each iwi has its own self-determination, if you like. And I want to make reference to two iwi. I'm talking about Waitaha and Ngāti Pikiao. Ngāti Pikiao has a lot of assets, but we haven't quite mobilized the innovators. And we don't need gatekeepers. And so it's about us getting started on developing the innovators to look at our own self-determination. How that will map out, we will probably need to have a session with your funding expert, this Mr. Ingalls, at some point in time to see how the game is played with Kāwanatanga and to capitalize on the all the utilities that we have here in Ngāti Pikiao, the lakes, the geothermal connections to the forests. The Māori economy is very underestimated in this whole region. But what we need is the innovators to mobilize those resources. And we need to take more emphasis on the social equity, social capital, as opposed to money, money, money. Because the money comes after, once you develop your social capital. That is the quadruple bottom lines, the forests, the environment, the social and the cultural development, and economic development has to take those three things into account. That's all I wanted to say. I haven't said too much as it is. And tēnā rā koutou.
Tēnā koe. Matua maru mo tō kōrero whakaaro rangatira. Tēnā koe. Me anō hoki kia tātou katoa. Kua uti tātou. It is the hope that this has brought some clarity and some thinking for us. So thank you very much for your tautoko to Committee Māori. I'm sure we have our iwi leaders forum coming up at 1:30, so I'm sure we'll continue that kōrero matua maru in that forum. Kia koutou, kia tātou, he mihi kauana kia tātou. I will now pass the rākau back to my esteemed colleague, Councillor White, to whakaoti tā tātou hui me te karakia. Tēnā koe, te taru.
Ngā mihi e te tiamana, me koutou hoki e hui hui mai nei i tēnei rā, kei te mihi atu ki a koutou, ki a kaha, ki a mai, ki a mana wenui. He kare ki a poto mō tātou, kei noi tātou, ki a tau, ki a tātou katoa. Ki a ta whai o tō tātou ari ki a Ukraine, me te arohati atua, me te whiwhinga tahitanga, ki te wairua tātou, ake, amen.
Kia ora tātou, ngā mihi.